I am here with Dr. Douglas Morgan, Adventist historian par excellence. It is my pleasure and privilege to speak with Dr. Morgan on a subject he has written extensively about, and that is the life of Lewis Charles Sheaf. Lewis Charles Sheaf, L.C. Sheaf, and you spell his name L-E-W-I-S, Lewis Sheaf, S-H-E-A-F-E. Dr. Morgan has written this book, Lewis C. Sheaf, Apostle to Black America. And Dr. Morgan indeed has written several fine books on Adventist history, one of them being Adventism and the American Republic, which I will put the link to that. You can download it for free on the Adventist Archives website, AdventistArchives.org. You can download that for free. And that has shaped many Adventist historians' doing of historiography. I know just recently, Kevin Burton and Jeffrey Rosario spoke about that, how that has shaped the way that they do historiography. And of course, Dr. Morgan taught at Washington Adventist University in the history department for 25 years. And so he shaped a core of Adventist historians teaching there. He is the author of Miracle of Courage, Color, and Christ, a fine local church history on First Church in Washington, D.C. And I will also put a link to that below. And he is the North American Division Editor for the Encyclopedia of Seventh-day Adventists. And that has just recently made its debut. And the web address for that is encyclopedia.adventist.org, encyclopedia.adventist.org. And the encyclopedia is still soliciting authors for that. And so I will include the link to that below, as well as Dr. Morgan's email address, because authors are still needed in many ways. The Encyclopedia Project is just beginning. Now, I would say about 12 years ago, I was eating with Dr. Morgan in the Washington Adventist University cafeteria, and Dr. Morgan expressed a desire to me that he be the world's leading sheafologist. The world's leading sheafologist. And I think that he is definitely that, not only with writing this book, but he has a website, lcsheaf.org, lcsheaf.org. And after you read this book, this is 450 pages. I once remarked to Dr. Morgan that I know more about Sheaf probably than his mother did. And so it is a fine work. Doc, can you tell us how you came about researching Lewis Sheaf?
Yes, I was asked to work on that history of the First Church that you referred to earlier. By the way, thank you for the opportunity to talk with you, Dr. Baker. I greatly appreciate it. When I got into that project, I began to see more and more things about Sheaf that were of great interest, and found that actually there does seem to be enough for a book here, just sort of snowballed, and was, you know, a very enjoyable journey as a historian.
Can you tell us how you became an Adventist historian?
Well, it's a combination, I think, of the fact that I sort of went with things that interested me as I progressed through my education. I course, as most of us would like to have the same level of comfort to which I was used to, but that wasn't a terribly high standard, I guess. In other words, I was more, you know, I didn't really feel like I had to go into a sure money-making career. And so history and religion classes were always my favorites. And I had some teachers that inspired, and nobody really said, oh, you must do that. But just by their example, their classes, so forth, I became, that field became appealing to me. I was a theology major, so, and a history minor. And then I went in various zigzagging directions for a while, but never went into pastoral ministry, and then ended up going into the University of Chicago History of Christianity program.
So you have a theology undergrad?
Yes, sir.
I didn't realize that. You know, I do too.
Yes, I think I was aware of that, but yeah.
And when you're dealing with theology majors, Adventist theology majors, it's an easy segue into Adventist history.
Oh, yes, I think so. Yeah. Because you mentioned my years at WAU, in part due to the relative size of the program, the student bodies, I actually found among the theology majors kind of a rapport, sometimes even a little more than I had with the majors in history and political studies. It's really apples and oranges, but I am taking your point to say that there is something of an interest there, even for those who are not inclined to do much study and preparation for tests, and not particularly inclined scholarly, I suppose, or motivated for that at the moment. But there's a curiosity there, an interest, and so they're, you know, it resonates with them.
Yes, and some of your formative influences were Jonathan Butler,
yes,
and Carl Schroeder, right?
Yes, at the college, Union College, Lincoln, Nebraska. Those were the two principal influences, along with H. Ward Hill, who was a theology religion teacher. But Jonathan Butler had just completed his doctorate at the University of Chicago, and his first 2 years after that were at Union, and that happened to be my freshman and sophomore years there. And then Carl Heinz Schroeder did not arrive until it might have been my senior year, but I took all the courses I could from him, and then I worked at Union in various capacities over the next few years, off and on. Like I said, it was a zigzagging path, but I had a lot of opportunity to converse with Carl Heinz and learn from him. So yeah.
Yes, and of course you did your doctoral studies under Martin Marty.
Yes.
Yes, a giant in that field.
Indeed.
All right. Let's get into the life of Lewis Schieff. A giant in Adventist history. He lived from 1859 to 1938, so we see how his life spanned epochs in American history and Adventist history. He was born shortly before the American Civil War and died just before World War II. And so he experienced the emancipation and maturation, if you will, of Black America and concurrently the Adventist Church.
Yes.
And so just his life spanned these foundational eras. And so just by virtue of being alive, he is, his life encapsulates so much. But tell us why we should care about Sheaf and who Sheaf was.
Yes, well, depending on one's perspective, he could be of interest in many different ways, but thinking of it primarily in the Adventist framework, I think that his story shows, number one, a surprising to me and impressive extent to which Adventism was appealing to someone who was dedicated to racial uplift, for advancing the cause of his people. But at the same time, it shows the limitations and the struggles that the Adventist Church would have over race and is still very much grappling with to this day.
I would also say, and your book powerfully points this out, that his life intersected with so many key Adventist figures.
Yes.
There was, of course, Ellen White, A.T. Jones,
Kellogg,
John Harvey Kellogg, A.G. Daniels, W.A. Spicer, some of the giants in the Black work, and of course, Adventist work.
Yes.
Because these are just giants, period. Yes. W.H. Green, G.E. Peters, J.K. Humphrey, Matthew Strawn, Sidney Scott, Charles Kinney. So he was interacting with all these people.
Yes, indeed.
And meaningfully.
Yes.
But he was also a prototypical visionary. Because he seeded, if you will, what became the Adventist church structure. And I'm getting all this from your book, by the way. So in 1901, he suggested what would become the Negro Department in 1909.
Yes.
Of course, he lobbied for Black autonomy and leadership. And that materialized with regional conferences. He foresaw interracial, and he foresaw and worked for interracial Adventist churches. And this still remains our ideal. So he was a visionary in many ways. And once again, as you point out, he mentored and baptized many key Black Adventist leaders.
Yes.
Who were some of those, Doc?
Well, you mentioned Green. W.H. Green was one of the first to join the Adventist Church through Sheaf's ministry in Washington, D.C. Another would be John H. Wagner a little bit later. Those are the two examples that come readily to mind, are those that he actually baptized, and those are two huge ones. But he certainly was also, go ahead, please.
And he also, would you say that he mentored F.L. Peterson?
That is an interesting possibility, in the sense that from Sheaf's perspective, I think that he felt that he did during an evangelism campaign when Peterson was either a student or had just graduated. And this is in about 1914 in Los Angeles. Mm. And Sheaf writes in his report for the review that, you know, Peterson did a good work. How much of an imprint that left on Peterson is hard to say. Certainly they viewed the Adventist situation in sharply different ways at a later point.
Yes, and we take a fictional character like Forrest Gump. He is in all of these historical places.
Yeah.
At these pivotal moments. Yes. And Sheaf is obviously not that because he's a player. Yeah. He's a catalyst, but he's at GC sessions, pivotal GC sessions, 1901. Yeah. He's in Louisville at the turn of the century. He's in Los Angeles as Black Adventism there is bubbling.
Yes. Yes. You know, I might just interject that, you know, you asked why should we study him? I think that you could also make an interesting case study about him from the perspective simply of African-American history, because here was someone who was connected with the Afro-American League, the Afro-American Council, the NAACP, the Universal Negro Improvement Association, not to mention various church affiliations. So just this fascinating progression of someone who is searching for levers, so to speak, in this great goal of advancing the well-being of his people.
Yes, I want to read some excerpts from your book. We are still setting the table, as it were, for Sheaf, just so that the listeners can know who he was before we get into the details of his life. John Harvey Kellogg wrote of Louis Sheaf, "He is an orator, a wonderfully able man. He is a more liberally educated and cultivated man and can deliver a more forcible address than any other Seventh-day Adventist minister. We have not a white minister that can begin to stand beside him. He commands the respect of everybody where he goes." Mm-hmm. That's John Harvey Kellogg, and I'm reading from Dr. Morgan's book. A.G. Daniels, the General Conference president, when Sheaf was in Washington, D.C., and the longest serving GC president, 1901 to 1922. Daniel says he is a talented man, both as a speaker and a singer, and has the fullest confidence of all his people. "So far as I know, there is not a colored man among our people in the South who has the respect and confidence of the whole colored department of our people that Elder Sheaf has." Mm-hmm. Doc, can you tell us who Calvin Chase was?
Yes, he was the editor of the Washington Bee newspaper, African-American newspaper. The Bee, honey for your friends, stings for your enemy. I haven't quite got the quote right. He was a Republican political operative, influential man in Washington, D.C.
He writes, "Reverend Louis C. Sheaf, D.D., the Seventh-day Adventist, the divine who has made all ministerial and Christian Washington to open their eyes with amazement. The distinguished divine is the most learned minister in the United States among the Negroes, and is equal to any white. Wherever he goes, people flock to hear him. Since his advent in this city, he speaks to packed houses, irrespective of creed or sex. No man has a greater knowledge of the Bible." Now, of course, back then the newspaper accounts were a bit hyperbolic, but you get the point. And Calvin Chase again said of Sheaf, in 1916, "Reverend Sheaf is one of the greatest Bible scholars in the United States and one minister who thinks for himself."
Yes, sir.
All right, all right, all right. Let's get into Sheaf's life. He was born November 16, 1859. Doc, can you tell us about his parents, where he was born, his upbringing, things like that?
So he was born in Baltimore, Maryland, to Joseph and Louise Sheaf. They were freed people, but not in the sense of after the Civil War, but they had gained their freedom prior to the Civil War, but they had started out life as enslaved people. Apparently, Sheaf's father, Joseph, served in the Union Army. There's only one passing reference to him that I have found, and we simply do not know. At least as the world's leading sheepologist, although I would love for someone else to, if they were to find more information, have not been able to find any more about the father. We don't know what happened to him, but the family moved. He had a brother, and his mother took her sons to the Boston, Massachusetts area when Lewis was about 5 years old. So he grew up, came to youth and manhood in the Massachusetts, not right in Boston, but in Massachusetts.
And it was a rural area, right?
Yes, yes. Not far, far into the hinterland, but he was a farmer for a while. He was a teamster for a while. He kind of did various things before he went into ministry, but farming was one of them. So yeah, it's a little bit out of the city.
I can't help but think of the starting line analogy, especially when you look at blacks of that era, The things that they accomplished and how far they were from just the starting line.
Yeah.
Sheaf's parents were slaves.
Yes.
And we don't know the type of slaves that they were, right?
Oh, yeah, yeah. But it's Maryland, so it's probably not going to be plantation slave. It could be. We think of Frederick Douglass, I guess. But anyway, yeah, we don't know.
But his father fought for the Union and was instrumental in liberating the slaves. This is good stuff. Now, he had an eye injury when he was about 10 years old, somewhat similar to Ellen White, I would say, somewhat similar to her injury.
Yes.
You know what happened to him?
I don't know exactly what happened to him, but another similarity stemming from this with Ellen White was that he found it difficult to study. He couldn't concentrate for long periods of time. So he describes his education as desultory. In other words, here and there a little bit. So I also connect with your earlier observations about his background. He had some innate brain power that was at a very high level. He was quick to learn and eventually won the accolades that you just read about from Calvin Chase as learned and best Bible scholar that Chase knew of. But he didn't sort of just get that from the ground up because of the injury. He does speak, though, of his mother encouraging him in his education. So there's a slight hint there that she had, at least a strong desire to see her children progress in that way.
And you believe that he may have had a glass eye?
That's what I conclude from the pictures. And also, there are some references, not too many that I found, but people who make observations about the way he looks at you, but kind of strange in some way. So he seems to have one
that
eye.
That would come up later.
Yeah.
That would come up later in the correspondence.
Yes, yes.
People would refer to that. So does that mean that he could have been blind in one eye?
I think so. Yeah, I think definitely. I think he had only one eye that was functional.
Mm.
And that's from, again, from childhood, 1869 is the date he gives. He would have been about 10 years old, 9 or 10 years old.
So that, has that affected your scholarship on Chief? The fact that he was partially blind? I mean, how did you treat that? I mean, does that come up?
Yeah. I must say that I don't feel that I really explored that angle. I thought about it and I wondered if I should do more. And I have an acquaintance who is an ophthalmologist. I get the terminology confused. Yeah. And he had actually agreed to look at the pictures for me and make whatever determination he could, but somehow that never happened. Now, one slight connection though would be that there are periodic references to health difficulties.
Yes.
That Chief had, and that was actually his path to Adventism. And so whether that was somehow connected with this childhood injury, possibly. It's hard to say.
Now, did he wear, looking at his pictures, I haven't seen him with glasses.
At least one photo, there is one of him as a very young man. Yeah, this one right here.
You can see. Raise it a little higher. Okay. Okay.
There you go.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
But after that, I can't quite tell on this one. Can you see, there it is. Yeah.
Yeah, maybe. Yeah. Yes, he has on glasses. Yes, he does.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. But then the cover, no glasses. So.
Well, he probably just took the glasses off for the photo.
Okay. Sure. Sure.
Interesting. Okay, tell us about his conversion to Christianity. He was about 15 years old?
Yes, and he was a seeker for truth. He had a desire to find out which denomination closely aligned with his own study of the Bible. Now, that's interesting. By now, 20 years old or so, doesn't seem to have any difficulty concentrating when he studies the Bible. So, you know, it's a bit of a puzzler, but he becomes a Baptist. He believes that is the one that lines up most closely with his beliefs, but it left unanswered questions. And by the way, that is from a brief autobiographical piece that he wrote before he became a Seventh-day Adventist. I think, for Adventists, we think, aha, there's a clue. He's searching and one day he'll find the truth. Well, we can take that line. But my point is, he wasn't planning that in his past because he ended up as a Seventh-day Adventist. He was describing himself as having unanswered questions even before he became an Adventist.
Hmm. Interesting. So he would have joined, if we look at the religious makeup of Black America in 1875, it would have a large portion of Blacks would have been Baptist, right?
Yes, definitely.
Probably Baptist, Methodist, and within Methodists, AME.
Right. But remember, he's in Massachusetts. And so he went to a seminary affiliated with the American Baptist, which be the Northern Baptist, basically, if we think of the pre-Civil War split. So he was not affiliated with a black denomination, so to speak. Whether his congregation that he worshiped with before going to seminary was a black church or not, again, I don't think I've found anything on that.
But we do know, well, he went to Wayland Seminary,
right,
in Washington, D.C. in 1885 to study for the ministry.
Right. And that school was set up specifically by the American Baptists to educate freedmen for the ministry. So it's part of that Northern project to try to do Christian duty to the freed people. Or on behalf
tell us
of
about can you tell us about his seminary years? I assume that seminary it wasn't quite a college. It was sort of like a specialized school,
right?
Purely for ministerial students, although they did have general ed.
Right.
They did have a general ed course of study, right?
Yes, and he was required to take that because he didn't come in with much by way of formal schooling. He would not have been a high school graduate. I think it's safe to say that. So he took this normal course. I think that he accelerated that a little bit, and then 2 years of the theological course.
And he met his wife at Wayland.
Yes, she was an English teacher. She taught in the normal program, the general education, more, you know, in more recent terminology. And he, as her student, was I think 5 or 6 years older than her. But anyway, yeah, that's how they got together.
So there may have been a power differential, you know, teacher to student. But he was older than her.
Yes.
Okay. Can you tell us a little bit about her? Can you tell us a little more about her? Annie?
Yes.
What was her last name?
Her maiden name was Annie Howard. She was a thoughtful and somewhat poetically inclined, and I gather musically inclined young woman, obviously well educated. You have to have some kind of training. Again, the specifics are hard to come by, but she's teaching in this seminary for training ministers. I think we can say that she had her own commitment to the cause of Christ. She took missionary work. She became a Bible worker herself, and she took all of that, seems to have taken all of that very seriously.
Yes, he had two, well, Sheaf was married twice, right?
Yes.
Annie would die from tuberculosis.
That's right.
And both of his wives figure prominently in his life.
Certainly.
Yes. I mean, they were powerful figures in their own right.
Yes, they were partners in ministry. Definitely.
All right. So Sheaf is at Wayland, and near the tail end of his studies at Wayland, he gets a pastorate in Alexandria, Virginia, right next to just south of DC, and he's ordained.
Yes.
All while on the seminary. And so he starts this is his first big city assignment. Because Alexandria and DC were like, it's like one big city. And so he begins his ministry. Do we know anything about his ministry in Alexandria?
Well, this was a very small congregation. And so I gather that it is perhaps part of his education, like a practicum, or it may have simply been the case that here was an exceptionally gifted student, and a small church like that in a congregational type of polity cannot afford to pay much, but it's a good opportunity to get experience. And he also showed a trait that runs through his life of kind of an entrepreneurial business skill. He left them much better off financially than he found them. But it was a small congregation, he worked with them there. But when he was truly ready to for a call to, you know, to begin his pastoral vocation in earnest, I think he was not looking to stay there. He was looking for other opportunities.
Talk to us about his first call.
It was to Pilgrim Baptist Church in all the way up in St. Paul, Minnesota. But apparently it was pretty well known among Northern Baptist circles as one of the more attractive and appealing Black churches, Black congregations in the Northern Baptist world. It had been started by a group of slaves from Missouri, which was a border state, right? Had the Emancipation Proclamation did not apply to them because it was part of the Union, like Kentucky and Maryland, right? But it had slaves. So in that interim, between the Emancipation Proclamation, January 1863, and the ratification of the 13th Amendment in 1865, they essentially fled slavery and went up the Mississippi River. And this group, a man by the name of Hickman, was a prominent leader, started this church. And I think that they took the name Pilgrim because they were pilgrims out of slavery, and had come to their promised land in Minnesota.
And so 1888 is an important year for Sheaf because he marries Annie on June 6th.
Yes.
And he starts his ministry in December. And of course, we know what happened with the Adventist Church, October, yes, November 1888. Can you, yes, talk to us about that, yes, that connection?
Yeah. They did actually overlap a little bit. What I mean is the Adventist General Conference and the other meetings that they had in relation to that, because Sheaf preached in St. Paul on November 4. He didn't formally take up his duties and bring his wife there until December, but from his sermon, a summary of his sermon on November 4, he tells his congregation, "I come among you to know nothing other than Jesus Christ and Him crucified." At the same time that the Adventists were famously in this struggle over, you know, will we be a Christ-centered denomination or not? Whether he had any awareness of that, it's not impossible, since the meetings were reported in the papers of that time. But it's just an interesting juxtaposition in view of later developments.
And A.T. Jones would factor prominently in his life. And
she's, yes, yes. And Jones spoke in the Minneapolis-St. Paul, the Twin Cities area there at not too long afterwards, but it would have been, by that time, Sheaf would have been well into his pastorate, 1891, on religious liberty. And the meetings were, again, this was in the general papers, which, you know, there's every chance that he was aware of that, whether he attended there and, you know, first got some kind of sense of what the Adventists were about. Don't know, but it's possible.
Please talk to us about Chief's early civil rights activism in Minnesota.
Well, he, as one could expect, I think, from an African American minister of the gospel, there is really no separation of the gospel from the pressing needs of the Black situation of oppression. And so right from the get-go, he is making connections between the two. And the Afro-American League was organized as an early civil rights organization soon after he began his pastorate. And he was involved in the St. Paul chapter prominently and spoke at meetings. I think his office was the chaplain of the St. Paul chapter. And there was a newspaper editor there by the name of John Q. Adams, and he published The Appeal, which had also Chicago, Louisville, and at times a couple of other cities where it was sold. So Adams claimed it was a national newspaper, but be that as it may, he definitely was someone who was connected in with the whole culture of the racial elite, if you will, of Black America, people who were taking leadership responsibility for the well-being of their people. And so Chief is very much a part of that right from the beginning of his ministry.
And did he speak on the same program, same platform as Ida B. Wells?
Yes, there was a national convention of Black teachers, and they had their convention there, and he spoke at that meeting. It was quite an interesting meeting, and this Appeal newspaper is wonderful because it gives a lot of details about these things. But apparently it went on and on and on into the night. That there was another famous a Black orator at that time, Joseph C. Price, who spoke. Chief spoke, and we've all been at meetings, church services, or special occasions where everybody is going on and on and on. And by the time Ida B. Wells got up, it was like past midnight. She says, "I'm not even going to give my speech," but then they kind of urged her on. So I think she made a few remarks. But yeah.
This is when you begin to identify in your book that Chief is actively casting about and looking for ways to help the Black race.
Yes.
For ways to help his people.
Yes.
How would you describe him as a civil rights activist in this early period?
Well, several things come to mind. One is the national scene where Jim Crow is making some early advances. The Reconstruction period has come basically to an end. 1877 is the date usually given for that. But you have a period of where things are still in flux. It's really in the late 1880s and early 1890s where we start to have the southern states put in segregation laws. And so these organizations, such as the Afro-American League, although they would face some criticism for, well, how much did they actually do, but they were at least alert to that danger. But there's another aspect, a more local aspect. Chief was concerned that the church be open to all classes. One thing that brought Black people to the Twin Cities was the hotel industry. And so you had some people who were, I guess you could say migrant transient workers in a way, but typically would not be the respectable middle class types. But Chief wanted to make sure that they were included. I think was another aspect. Lynching is also kind of back to a national scene, but lynching is also coming onto the scene. And one of the early events that he was associated with in 1891, I believe it was, day of prayer and fasting that was organized to call for legislation against lynching.
This is the dovetailing of religion and anti-racist activism.
Yes.
And as a minister of the Black Church, Chief was a de facto political leader.
Right.
Quote unquote politics. Like I said, the Black Church really didn't make those distinctions.
Right.
Minister was a leader in the Black community just by virtue of being a minister of a church.
Right.
Chief was expected to work in the community, to protest against racism, to chip away at you know, discriminatory laws and policies.
Yes. He preached a sermon called Rights, Civil and Otherwise. And one of the main points was that the church needs to be the foundation of action for civil rights. And so he really saw that essential connection between the two, and that, the church should be involved, but also part of his message was don't sort of marginalize the church either as a fountain and resource for upholding rights.
When would you say that Chief began to develop an oratory prowess?
Oh, well, I think that is evident right from his initial pastorate there. And to a certain degree in the seminary, because he was highly recommended by his professor there for that position in St. Paul. But the accolades such as you read, they begin to appear not just in the appeal, but there were occasions where the general papers, the white-owned papers, would report in very admiring terms about Chief as a speaker.
And he took the third prize in the popular preacher. There was popular preacher poll.
Yes, yes, yes. Yeah, so the appeal, you know, is kind of like a fundraising gimmick in a way, but apparently, you know, people got into it. And so the appeal, since they link Chicago, Louisville, and at least one or two other cities with St. Paul, it was a competition between the pastors in those cities. And they would, sustain readership and sort of build interest. Their weekly tallies, you know, oh, Chief is in first place or whomever. No, but now the other one is taking over the lead. And so anyway, yeah.
All right, now 1892, he moves to Ohio. Can you tell me how did the assigning of churches go in the Baptist church in the 1890s? Do you know?
Well, it is in accordance with the Baptist congregational polity. So the congregation as a board of elders or trustees, goes under differing titles, And they hire the minister. So he had to make his availability known. Exactly how that was done, can't say for sure, whether he sent out resumes or let it be known in publications or however, but he had to seek it and then receive an invitation to give a trial sermon, that sort of thing.
Okay. So he goes to Youngstown in 1892. What was happening in Youngstown? I mean, Youngstown is one of those places where it's so different at different points of American history.
Yeah.
You know, at one point it's almost a large city with a lot of mafia violence and car bombing. And then as the Rust Belt declines, its population also declines. But what was it like? What was Youngstown like in the early 1890s?
Well, it was more up and coming economically. Yeah. And beginning to be kind of the industrial center that it would eventually be. I don't think that it was quite what it would be at its height in the 20th century before its decline. But 1893, there was a economic panic and a really severe depression. So that was a huge setback to Youngstown. It was felt all over, but I think it hit Youngstown particularly hard while Sheaf was there.
And how would you characterize the Black community there?
Yeah, it's a fairly small congregation. Now, again, he helps them, I believe, either get a new building or help pay it off. They seem to appreciate him. I should also mention that there is a Black newspaper called the Cleveland Gazette. Mm-hmm. And so people from his church in Youngstown, as well as Sheaf himself, would occasionally be mentioned in this paper. So they're kind of linked to a middle-class culture, if you will, in that way. I might be repeating myself, that it's a fairly small group, but he seems to have had a genuine fellowship. There seemed to be a genuine mutuality of feeling there, but he did not stay long. And it could be, again, the explicit reasons are just not there. Yeah. But it might not have been financially satisfactory. That 1893 downturn economically could have created pressure, and that led him to take another small town pastorate, but more of a solid proposition. I get the impression the Second Baptist Church in Urbana, Ohio.
Now, while he's in Youngstown, he has an approach to, we won't even call it civil rights activism or anti-racist activism. He wants to help the Black community.
Right.
He wants to help the community in which his church is located. And he has a poll in which he polls the Black population, and he says, How can we help you? He says, quote, "I have a desire to help my people along all lines of life."
Yes.
And so he sends out a poll and says, what can our congregation do to help you?
Right.
What are the needs of this community? And he comes up with, his census is seven questions. His census is seven questions, and I want to read these because I think that they are important when we're thinking about the role of a minister in a community and what his involvement should be. Number one, How do the Negro children in public schools compare with others? How many Negroes are in our city? How do the Negroes compare with foreigners as citizens? What proportion of criminals are Negroes? And I think that he's being very shrewd in the question he's asking, because he's looking for underlying bias and racism. He's not only addressing the issues in the Black community, but he's looking at the proportionality of crime. Are we targeted more? So he's, even in these early years, Scheef is very shrewd.
Right. He's seeking information from the white community, because it was the police chief that gave his copy of the survey to the newspaper. Yeah. So I think all of those kind of assessments and agendas that you mentioned are plausibly on his mind. But something that you quoted there, I thought struck me again as very significant, that he sees it as part of his role as a minister of the gospel to take responsibility for the well-being of his people, his community, within the larger community.
Yes. Number five, has the Negro made any real progress in the past 10 years? If any, along what lines? What are the greatest needs of the Negro today? What is the Negro's future? So these are the questions. And you said that these were directed at whites, or?
That's my impression, that he's trying to figure out how the Black community is perceived, and to get some kind of database to work with, as opposed to just stories, you know, and anecdotes and so forth. So I think it's impressive from that angle as well. I don't have any credential for saying, oh, this is a very sophisticated social scientific instrument, but it's in that mode, trying to take an intelligent, well-informed
yes,
path to addressing.
These were some of the same issues that Du Bois explored in what they call the first sociological study of Black Americans, his work on Philadelphia.
Aha, uh-huh. Interesting, yeah.
These are some of the exact same concerns. Look at what he says. This is when he was in Urbana. So we can go ahead and move to Urbana. But he says, and this is his mindset. Take, for example, the trade and labor unions of this country. How many of them will admit a Negro to membership? He may be a workman of the first order that has no weight if his face is Black. Remove the barriers in the city of Urbana. Give the Negro an equal chance. What would constitute an equal chance, you ask? Quote, we ask no favors on account of color. If the Negro fails after he has had the opportunity of 500 years of education, we're speaking again about the starting line, and training as the white man has, then count him inferior. But you can't in fairness overlook the long start the white man has had of the Negro, nor the fact that obstacles without number are purposely put in his path. Now listen to this. I'm still quoting Scheef. The white man has long used the Negro to pull his chestnuts out of the fire. Then when he has cracked and eaten the meat, gives the Negro the shell, and now you are amazed that the Negro has not gotten fat on such a diet. Just advise the white man to stand aside, and you will see that the Negro will come out all right yet. So we're dealing with Rayford Logan's nadir mm-hmm. of race relations.
Yes.
And whites are starting to engage, well, really increasing the racial terrorism.
Yes.
And the devastation on the Black community. So Scheef is saying here, just get out of our way.
Right.
Just let us be. It's somewhat akin to Booker T. Washington's exposition speech But he's really not, Schieff is really not asking for white help, as Washington did. He's just saying, get out of our way and let us work.
Yes. Yes. Yeah.
So tell us about his time in Urbana.
Well, I think that he emerges as a speaker and leader who is well known throughout the state of Ohio, a very significant populace and state that figures large on the national scene as a orator, someone who's involved in Christian uplift, youth uplift, prohibition causes, but also as an orator on racial issues. So you will be called upon to speak for public and civic occasions. And again, we see all over the place, people just expressing superlatives about his preaching. By the way, that metaphor of what the walnuts and the meat and so forth, I think that was one of the ways in which his speaking was very powerful.
Yes.
He used vivid metaphors, picture language, and that was part of it. But there's just one example of him as a pulpit orator. There was a church this is Terre Haute, Ohio, not Terre Haute, Indiana, Terre Haute, Ohio, tiny little crossroads, I think. But there was a church out there, and there's a report in the Urbana paper, one of the Urbana newspapers, about how he was called upon to speak there, and the people were just enthralled, but some had stayed away because he was a black man, and how much they had missed out on a wonderful experience there. So that I think, but another significant point in connection with that is that he becomes well accepted, comfortable in a way, interacting with white groups and white audiences. Not to say that he's just blending in and not aware of all of the issues of disparity and injustice and so forth, but he gets a considerable degree of acceptance and recognition from there was something called the Young People's Society for Christian Endeavor that was a big deal, the prohibition cause and so forth, and just as a preacher.
Well, his time in Urbana, one of the newspapers, and you criticize the newspaper account and say that they were purposely trying to create acrimony toward Schieff, but the Cincinnati Commercial Gazette.
Yes.
So Schieff at the time he was speaking in Springfield,
right,
which would be about an hour from Cincinnati.
Right.
So the Cincinnati Commercial Gazette reports, quote, Reverend Schieff made a fiery speech in which he denounced Lincoln, saying that he issued the Emancipation Proclamation only as a war measure. He said that the colored people were very little better off today than they were before the war, and frequently pointed to the flag, which was above his head in scorn, and said it protected none but the white people, and that the colored people could not call it their flag. His speech was frequently interrupted by cries of stop from the audience and did not find much favor with the audience. Now I believe that you likened Louis Schieff to Colin Kaepernick in an article.
Yes, yes, absolutely.
And so here we see him challenging the flag and what it stood for, even though this is a biased and sort of a hit piece on, yes, on Schieff.
Yes.
Do you think that he was critical of the flag?
Well, he gave his own explanation of the event, and I think it's helpful to set the scene. This was an Emancipation Day. For a while, there was celebrations of the preliminary Emancipation Proclamation in September of the year. So that was the event. And it was also kind of a Republican, an opportunity for Republican politicians to, you know, strengthen their connection with the black vote and get some support. And the governor, the candidate for governor, Bushnell, was there. And so that's why there's a big flag festooned behind the speaker's platform. So Chief's point was, we, 200,000 black troops, including his father, essentially saved the Union. Just by the way, Lincoln himself acknowledged the critical role of the black troops. But be that as it may, still, you know, there was a major contribution made, and he's saying, but what has been our reward for that? He says that who has been more hoodwinked, abused, and scorned as the Negro. And so his point is simply the same as Kaepernick's, not to defame what the flag stands for, but to say that it hasn't, those ideals have not been experienced by the black community, which, by the way, stood up and made such a huge contribution to the sustaining of the Republic. And it's also, though, a challenge. He's laying down a challenge to no longer mindlessly follow the Republican Party and to vote the Republican ticket. Because the Republicans just are not sustaining any kind of real program. For example, this was not all that long after the Lodge voting rights bill had been in Congress, and it got traded away for a better tariff rate. In the exchange over what what legislation will be passed, the Republicans surrendered voting rights, enforcing voting rights for blacks in the South for an economic benefit in the legislation. He refers to Ida B. Wells, who is presenting her pleas before Congress, before the nation. Nothing is done. So that's another aspect of that.
Just a little bit of a background for our viewers. There was a shift of blacks from the Republican Party. Like, you'll hear the modern day Republicans say that it was Republicans who freed the slaves. That is a very problematic assertion. But in the 1920s and 1930s, with FDR and his social policies, this is when we see the great shift of black voters from the Republican Party to the Democratic Party. And so back then, the Republicans may be thought of as the Democrats of today. Doc, you think we can say that?
Well, yes, certainly closer than the other way around.
Here is what Chief said about the relationship of blacks and the Republican Party of that day. And this is during his Urbana time. I think this is near the time, this is his speech in Springfield. Quote, "My position is that the Negro is not under obligation to any party, but that the Republican Party is under everlasting obligations to the Negro. I am not blind to the fact that no one party has a monopoly upon all the righteousness that there is in politics, even as meager as it is. Schiff is critiquing everything, isn't he? The party that has been supported so nobly by the Negro has not discharged its obligations to him. Still quoting, what the Negro needs is simply to demand his own and cease to be a tail for any political kite. Demand proper protection and recognition. And if these are not forthcoming, make the party that receives his support feel the weight of that demand when made by the 27,000 Negro voters of Ohio. That's Louis Schiff.
Sure.
That is Louis Schiff.
Yeah.
Coming with the fire. That's Schiff. All right, Doc, let's talk about Schiff's conversion to Seventh-day Adventism. We are talking mid-1896. Please set the stage for that.
Sometime earlier in 1896, he went to Battle Creek Sanitarium, Michigan, being the adjacent state to the north. He periodically throughout his ministry, he would need to take time off, perhaps simply a vacation, just, you know, to be cleared of the pressures that had been building up. But it could have been something more definable than that. At any rate, he goes to the Battle Creek Sanitarium and gets good treatment there and becomes convinced concerning the Seventh-day Adventist teachings. That process is not entirely clear, although from Kellogg's correspondence, he claims to kind of had shepherded that process, but he doesn't give a lot of detail. So, yeah. Uh-huh.
All right. What do you think it was? You talked earlier about his sort of eternal search for the truth.
Yeah.
You think that was a factor in his embrace of Seventh-day Adventism?
Yes. And again, it might be that my lens on it is, or maybe I should put it this way, my antenna is out for that type of thing. But it does seem to me that, okay, here's somebody who never felt that his questions were answered. And he's someone, look, he's not going to accept the conventional wisdom about the Republican Party. So he's early on in saying, well, I'm still a Republican, but we cannot just simply follow their lead. We got to think this through. And so I think that he was a continual searcher for truth. And so he found much that was impressive in the doctrinal teachings of the Adventist Church, but then also in the holistic message that transformed lives via education and healthcare. That was an extremely important part of the appeal of Seventh-day Adventism to Louis Schiff.
Yeah, and one of the bedrocks of his activism was moral suasion and Black uplift.
Yes.
And many early Black activists who were drawn to Seventh-day Adventism were impressed by the holistic approach.
Yes.
Of Adventists.
Yes.
And in fact, I think that Schiff would envision a Utopia Park Benevolent Association type resort before James K. Humphrey did.
Right.
And so he was very into health, the rest that the Sabbath offered, the literacy that was almost embedded in Adventism. I mean, you know, Adventists have been called a people of the book. So you had to be able to read really to understand Seventh-day Adventism.
Yes.
So there was that component.
Yes.
The abstention from liquor, tobacco, the increasing emphasis on clean eating and diet. So this is This is a holistic message. And you point out many times in your book that Sheath is casting about for organizations, programs, ideologies, societies that would uplift Blacks.
Yes. And remember that line that was part of what you read, where he's saying, well, I'm paraphrasing, there's good in both parties, well, such as there is. In other words, there's really not much good in either party. And so I think that his disillusionment with the Republican Party, which had done so much that was promising, I think that that has to be said. But now, back to Rayford Logan in his book, The Betrayal of the Negro, right? And so I think that he sees in Adventism something that is really promising as an alternative path to racial advance.
Yes, yes, yes. He preaches his first sermon on July 18 in the Battle Creek Tabernacle.
Yes.
Do we have the title of it?
Yes, it was on What Think Ye of Christ.
And his family moves to Battle Creek. He's not there long, but as was the early convention in Adventism, oftentimes when a minister converted from another denomination, they would have their Adventist ministerial credentials in no time, because they were a minister with another denomination.
Right.
So Sheath gets his ministerial credentials in late March of 1897.
Yes.
By the General Conference Committee.
Yep.
And his first ministerial assignment is it in Louisville, Kentucky?
Well, evangelism in Louisville, starting in May, and then by December, he is assigned to the Lexington, Kentucky Church.
Let's talk about the Lexington, Kentucky Church, one of the most storied Black Adventist churches. There you had James Alexander Childs, who was one of the first Blacks to argue a case before the U.S. Supreme Court. And he didn't win the case, but he was protesting segregation on public transportation. He bought a train ticket. I believe it was a first class train ticket. And he was told that he must vacate his seat and go to the colored car. And he did it, but he decided to fight it in court and try to overturn segregation on public transportation. You had Mary Britton, she and her sister Julia were tireless civil rights activists for Blacks and for women. And she was immortalized by Paul Laurence Dunbar in a tribute poem. Mm-hmm. Now, Alfonso Berry, or A. Berry, was one of the earliest Black, when Sheath was issued ministerial credentials by the General Conference Committee, was he one of what, about three Black Adventist ministers?
Yes, yes. I think in terms of ordination, which would come just a couple of years later for Sheath, but perhaps even in terms of credentialing, I'm not 100% sure on that, but Kinney, Berry, Sheath.
Okay. So A. Berry was a bit of a controversial person and perhaps had issues with management, with managing a church. What do we have the reasons why he left the Lexington congregation?
There's a personality conflict, I think, as part of it. In other words, Brother Berry seems to have kind of a brusque side to him. He and Childs clashed. Mary Britton at least in the few snippets I have seen here and there in correspondence, is seems to be the peacemaker, or seems to want to be the peacemaker. But there is a general consensus by 1898 that, let's have Brother Barry move to another congregation and bring in Sheaf.
Imagine that. Imagine a congregation with Sheaf, Childs, and Britton. Yeah. Come on now. That's some civil rights power.
Yes. Yes.
That is some civil rights power. All right. Yes. Sheaf takes the fast track, not only because he's charismatic, gifted, and brilliant, but he's one of only three black ministers.
Right.
And just to give a little context, if this is, so he comes to Lexington in 1896?
98.
Okay, 98. He's converted to Adventism in 1896, and around the same time, I believe November of that year, Oakwood, the Huntsville School, opens, and that's the church's sole HBCU. 2 years before that, James Edson White, Ellen White's son, along with Will Palmer and Emma White and Will Palmer's wife, they begin the Southern Missionary Society and construct the Morning Star and sail from Chicago down the Mississippi to down the Mississippi River to Memphis first and then Mississippi, Vicksburg, Yazoo City, Lintonia. So things are really percolating for the black work, even though there wouldn't be a demonstrable number of members coming in for a while.
Yes.
Things are percolating.
Yes,
and definitely. I think that we need to see Sheaf as a force that's apart from Edson.
Yes.
Edson White and the Southern Missionary Society.
Yes.
I think that our history has become whitewashed, literally, because we are preoccupied with the whites. But there is a whole nother strain of Black Adventism with Sheaf.
Yes, yes.
Now, can you talk about the beef between Sheaf and Edson White?
Well, a part of it has to do with the fact that the Medical Missionary Benevolent Association, headed by Kellogg, also is operating in the South. Now, there is some overlap, indeed, even some support from Kellogg for Edson's projects, but they're not coordinated, and indeed, there's an element of rivalry as well. So when Sheaf goes to the South, he is connected more with the Kellogg-backed projects, the steel orphanage near Chattanooga, for example. He would go there. You see, we talked about Lexington, but he was really only there for a little over a year. It was pretty much an itinerant ministry in the South. And so, but Edson viewed himself and his project as, you know, having responsibility and ownership or stewardship over the black work in the South. And so he makes
very paternalistic. Yeah,
he makes an overture to Sheaf to try to get Sheaf to work under his auspices. But Sheaf spurns that and makes it clear that he has a mind of his own. And Edson then is not very happy, and pretty much every subsequent reference that I've seen from Edson's correspondence to Sheaf is negative, and he's trying to, you know, warn against him, downplay his influence, and so forth.
And this is from your book. I think this is a major motif in Sheaf's life. He does not necessarily fall in line or fall under any white person and their program.
Yes.
He has been accused of being an uppity Negro. An uppity Negro. I think it's safe to say that that was the perception of him, that he was so gifted, so talented, and so black that he was intimidating.
Yes.
And when he would not fall under these white-led ministries, like I said, figuratively and literally, I think that that created, that fomented haters and acrimony.
Yes.
Now, Doc, I know from your book that there were other dynamics. I'm aware that there were other dynamics, but I think that that's an early motif that when you were a black minister in those years, that you had to be a little bit subservient.
Yes.
Or yielding to white ministries.
Yes. Yes.
And Sheaf is not necessarily a follower. He's more like a boss. He's more like a leader.
Right. 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 So, you know, charges being made, like there was a committee. This is a little bit before the Southern Union was formed, but not much more. But it said there that Sheaf tends to foment controversy. He's promoting equality in the South and so forth. But I think that one has to be aware of the kind of dynamics that you're talking about, because somehow when Sheaf actually is in the South, he managed to operate relatively successfully.
He's in the Upper South, right?
Well, yes, but South Carolina ends up being a significant center of his work. Now, none of it is huge numerically at this point, but that's not true for anyone else either. But he has some relative strong evangelistic successes in Georgetown, Kentucky. At least one white person comes in with that group, but then in Aiken, South Carolina, and also there was the college there. The name is slipping my mind.
Horry's.
That is another one, but in Orangeburg, you have South Carolina State, but it's slipping my mind. Anyway, the point is that, he was there in South Carolina. Now, he made brief trips all over Georgia, North Carolina, Tennessee, Kentucky, but I think the fact that he has relative success, congregation is established in Aiken. I have to take that into account. I read what his opponents say, or those who say that he's not fit to work in the South, and I don't dismiss it. But I think that the kind of dynamics that you're speaking of also have to be taken into account. Here's someone that we can't really control, we'd rather just have him out of our way. He's good. Let him preach somewhere else. Go north.
Yeah. I think that Edson's letters to his mother in Australia in the late 1890s were not wrong. That what he was experiencing in Mississippi was actually occurring.
Yes.
The persecution over their apparent color line flouting, and finally they were essentially run out of Mississippi. I think that what they were doing down there was different both in magnitude and modus operandi than what Sheaf was doing in South Carolina and Kentucky.
Yes.
So probably different dynamics and really a different just a different area. I mean, Mississippi was the worst of the worst.
Yes.
In terms of, slavery's legacy and the color line and the nadir of race relations. All right. How did Sheaf end up representing the colored race at the GC session of 1899. Why was it not Charles Kinney?
Well, I think you would know more about Kinney, but he seems to have had some health problems that did not completely end his career, because we read of some things that he's doing at least as late as the 19 teens, but he just seems to have faded somewhat from the picture.
Yeah, Kinney actually, the he's called the founder of Black Adventism. I believe that Ron Graybill first coined that. Kinney had actually a short ministry, as we may say that Chief did as well. I think Chief was only 12 years in Adventism. But Kinney, I'm not sure if he burnt himself out or what, but I think he retired in like 1904. And from there, he was sort of like a titular figure. He was an icon of Black Adventism. But I think that his minute, because he was converted in 1877, 1878 in Reno, Nevada, he went to Hellsburg College, today's PUC, and he began ministering in the Midwest and then the South, southerly, you know, I'm not sure what you would call St. Louis. And he ministered in other places, but his ministry must have been, I don't think that we could call it short, because it was 20 years. It was more than 20 years.
Right.
But he was handily and quickly replaced by Chief as the representative of Black Adventists.
Yes.
And Chief becomes, and this to me really justifies your book, because Chief becomes the point person for Black Adventism.
Yes. Yes.
Undisputed.
Yes. Right.
Now, please talk to me about Chief at the 1901 General Conference session, the foundational landmark General Conference session of 1901.
Right. Well, one of the issues there that was being discussed amidst all of the organizational changes was setting up department, committees, a ministry of some kind at the Union Conference level where relevant. Again, the Union Conferences are a whole new entity, but as they're being envisioned, for ministry to foreign language speaking immigrants, recent immigrants, mainly from Germany and Scandinavia. But this is their numbers are increasing vastly, and they're a prime mission field for Adventists in the upper Midwest especially. So Chief then, after that discussion, proposes something similar for the colored work. But something that you mentioned earlier in your introductory overview, I think is significant, because what he has in mind is not only something that would give organizational focus, but also give freedom to Black ministers to operate without feeling like they have a gag bit, was the or a ring, which I take also to mean something that you would hook an animal with and lead them around. He says, so that we can operate with
chattel term, yes, provocative chattel term.
Okay. Yeah. So that we can don't feel like you were being led around like that, but we can operate with freedom, and that will be the way to win more Black people. So they form a committee, ad hoc committee, to discuss it and then bring back a recommendation to the floor later, a day or two later in the proceedings. And I think because of the language of who was supposed to be on this ad hoc committee, that is people who are closest to the Black work, again, giving everything that you have just highlighted about his centrality, his significance, and the general recognition of him as the leader of that work, he was left out of this ad hoc committee. He didn't have any.
Was James Edson White, W.C. White, and was it Kilgore?
Yes. And they recommended that it was not, it was not something that would be needed at this point. So,
and this is just a little bit of background. This is during the same period when Ellen White is excoriating top church leaders for fraud and misappropriation of monies to the black work.
Hmm.
There were several drives, self-denial boxes among them, in which monies were being raised for the Southern work, which was the black work. And Ellen White accused the leaders, she said she was giving visions on it, accused the leaders of misappropriate, funneling that money away from the black work to evangelism among whites and for white institutions. And of course, there were continual issues. We'll speak about J.B. Buster, J.R. Buster, J.B. or J.R. Dot?
R, J.R. Buster.
Okay, yeah, J.R. Buster, about how he wasn't getting paid. He didn't have any money.
Right.
And so these black ministers were not being remunerated. Now, of course, there were issues with that across the spectrum of race in the denomination. But the black ministers really weren't getting remunerated, the three that there were, and by then there were more. And so the black work literally was not being operated, not even efficiently. It was on tenterhooks, you know, I mean, it was very poorly operated. So Sheaf said, if we have a department, at least we can have a systemic and sustained presence, perhaps on committees, definitely in the church headquarters, and the monies that are raised can be distributed by this department. I mean, it's representation. That did not exist. This was the way to go in Adventism. Already, the organizational talks and the organizational moves that were made in 1901, that's the major, you know, the reorganization was from 1901 to 1903. And the way for denominational representation so that the work could be done for your people was to have it riveted, embedded within the organization. So this is what Sheaf was calling for. If you didn't have a department, you didn't have a voice. And thus monies, human power, resources did not go to your work.
Yeah. And furthermore, he is not even allowed in the room when the thing is being discussed. So I think this was a harbinger or a preview of trouble to come, because he leaves early. Someone reporting on it or stating that fact said, well, he maybe was not feeling well or whatever, but he just leaves the session, and there is a supporter of Sheaf's from Ohio. It was a woman. I have no other knowledge about her, but she writes to Daniels complaining about the way Sheaf was treated at the general conference. And Daniels is saying, what do you mean? We had him preaching more than once. He had all the visibility that you could possibly want. But I think that what this person was complaining about was that he was given absolutely no say, even as someone who would be outnumbered 2-1 or whatever, he didn't even have any voice in this. And he's really cast into a position of uncertainty. Who's going to direct him now? I mean, he's part of the general conference, but what's he supposed to do? Daniels basically says, well, let the Lord lead you. And so it's kind of I think this is a early, frustration point for Sheev, and a building sort of antagonism, if you will, or skepticism about whether this organization is ever going to really work in a way that would have any kind of fairness for its Black members.
Now let's talk about what you have called Adventism and America's original sin. This is the center stage for Adventism's litmus test, their trial by fire of race relations, Washington, D.C., in the first decade of the 20th century. Matthew Strawn, a Black Adventist minister, says at the time, Washington, D.C. was the very seat of culture among the Negroes and, quote, the great Mecca of Negro intelligence and refinement. The city has a population of about 300,000, 100,000 of whom are Black. So it's about a third of the Black population. Please set the stage for us on Sheev's entry into Washington, D.C., and what A.G. Daniels and the denomination hope to do there.
Yes, well, the first Seventh-day Adventist congregation in Washington, D.C., organized in 1889. And by a decade later, it had 150 members, 100 white and 100 Black. And they didn't sit in separate parts of the congregation. This was a genuinely interracial congregation on principle. Both white and Black members, leadership figures in that congregation, wrote letters powerfully to their convictions in that regard. A.F. Ballinger, who was serving there for a time being as sort of a pastor revivalist, said this church is a miracle of the living God, composed as it is of the two races. And then I paraphrase beyond that a little, where he refers to the fact that the other churches, other denominations are amazed and impressed by this. So this was a mission, a growing, it was a congregation, but it was also a further missionary territory, if you will, an arena for evangelistic outreach that Daniels was interested in. And so he visited the Washington, D.C. tent that had been set up by the Adventists in the summer of 1901. So this was not long after the session that we just referred to.
And A.G., very quickly, A.G. Daniels had been elected president of the General Conference of Seventh-day Adventists, which was then headquartered in Battle Creek, Michigan.
Yes.
It had not moved to Tacoma Park, Washington, D.C. yet. That would happen in 03-04.
Correct. Correct. And so, now I should also say that there had been some building concern. I contend that this was a genuinely interracial congregation that sustained that commitment over a significant period of years. At the same time, though, the sort of typical or expected dynamic of growth on the part of the Black membership, more zeal for evangelism, more bringing of friends, and at the same time, the white members tending to, some of them, kind of disappear. They're no longer active. Less growth. So part of what Daniels is interested in is how do we help the Adventist cause to thrive in this city of influence, I mean, it's the capital of the United States, and it's also the capital of Black America, if you will, the largest concentration of Black population in any city of America at that time. But how do we deal with the race issue? And so they had a pastor there who just before this had tried to introduce separate seating, segregated seating within the congregation, and that caused a big kerfuffle. So he's aware of this issue. Well, he sees then when he comes to the tent, and he even preaches, but he reports that it seemed to be true that really the Black members and their friends are predominating, and that the white people just are not coming in to this evangelistic meeting. And he writes in a letter to W.C. White about all of the large and impressive Black churches of other denominations that he sees there in Washington. And so he conceives a plan to say, let us separate the current congregation into a white congregation and a Black congregation. But before we do that, let's have a major evangelistic thrust where we have a white minister and a Black minister. Hmm. And then their converts will be brought in, but to separate congregations. In other words, co-terminus or along with the evangelistic campaign, as it comes to its culmination, we will divide this into two congregations. And he knew Sheaf, he admired Sheaf, as you quoted earlier, but he also knew the things that various people had said about Sheaf, and he wanted to be sure that he had Sheaf's agreement on this plan, and he felt that he secured that. And then he invited Judson S. Washburn, who had previously served in Washington, but had been over in England for about a decade, and to this day is remembered in British Adventist history as an innovator, someone who did much to advance the growth, which had been rather slow previously. So Washburn then agrees to do this as well. But when the meetings get underway and the momentum builds, we find Sheaf getting an enormous amount of attention from the press, the Black newspapers, the white-owned general daily newspapers, and his congregations grow. He starts off, they set up 300 chairs in the tent, but pretty soon that is just way too small. Eventually, they're in a larger tent, and they've got 1,500 seats, but in some instances, as many as 2,000 or more. I mean, people are just crowding in, and they're interracial, probably majority Black, but people from government, you know, would come down, would just walk a few blocks and hear Sheaf.
And this is a predecessor to way before Cleveland's DC Crusade, way before C.D. Brooks's Warner Theater Crusade. So Sheaf, this is his rise as a city evangelist.
Oh, yes.
Not only in Black Adventism, but in Adventism in general. I mean, we have William Ward Simpson and others, but Sheaf is a powerful big city evangelist, a force to be reckoned with. He is the toast of Washington, D.C. He's at the height of his powers.
Right.
Yeah.
And in the meantime, Washburn is not doing so well, you know, in terms of attracting an audience to his meetings. Then the question comes, well, what are we going to do at the conclusion of the campaign per se in September, and the General Conference wants to carry out the plan of separating the church into two congregations along racial lines. But
so Doc, they're going to separate the existing First Church.
Yeah. Well, yeah.
And the incoming converts, black and white.
Right. So yeah, right, exactly. Yeah. But in the meantime, Sheaf has flipped, so to speak. In other words, he told Daniels, at least this is his perspective on their agreement, that I will go along with whatever the people on the ground want to do. In other words, I, as the black preacher, as part of this whole program, I'm not going to try to block a separation. But don't look to me, and this was explicitly said, don't expect me to lead it. Don't expect me to carry it out. And I think there's agreement that he made that stipulation. Well, when he got there, he found that close to half of the white people in this, it was just the Washington church before the division, did not want to divide the congregation. And in fact, were absolutely dedicated to the principle of racial equality and of bringing the races together into one equal and unified fellowship. And so then he kind of casts his lot with them, and Daniels is feeling betrayed, and Washburn is writing letters sort of complaining about Sheaf. And so it becomes a very confrontational atmosphere when this separation is carried out toward the end of September 1902. By the way, Chase, I mean, the newspapers are following this. They've become, their attention has been drawn to the Adventists because of Sheaf's campaign, but now the question of the division. And when Chase hears that the General Conference wants to implement this color line and separate by race, he's saying, oh, well, okay, there you go. The Adventists are partaking of the same vile fruit, partaking of the same poisoned tree, so yeah, to speak, of American racism. In other words, well, it looked like maybe the Adventists would be different. But
if I can just read what Calvin Chase says.
Sure. Remember,
he's a prominent black journalist, the editor of the Washington Bee, and he says, quote, and this is when word got out that the General Conference wanted to divide the new church, the members that just came in, and the existing church, the Washington Church, along racial lines, Calvin Chase says, quote, even in this new religious organization, the spirit of caste is being fostered and perpetuated. This offshoot of American Christianity partakes the venom of the parent tree, race prejudice.
Yes, right.
That's what Chase writes.
Right. So the division is carried out, but again, about half of the white people stay with the original congregation, and that then became the First Church, and then they formed a second church. Briefly, it was called that, with that Washburn led, composed the white members who wanted to go along with the plan. Later it became the Memorial Church. And I just want to also say that this got national press coverage. And the headlines are just, some of them are just devastating in Washington, D.C., like color line drawn between Adventists. It's also interesting how there is a different spin, even among the white newspapers, given to it. But one that I found after the book was published, you know, more and more newspapers go online and you can search them. This is from the Little Rock Arkansas Democrat. Mm. And I think they're happy about that. Mm. To exclude Negroes. Seventh-day Adventists draw the color line. I mean, that kind of just socks you in the gut just to see it brought up, but it was true. And so
Washington Evening Times, color line drawn between Adventists.
Yep.
Washington Post, Adventists will form two churches.
Yeah.
And you think that this was a disgrace, right? We had a golden opportunity.
Yes. Now it turns out that I don't think that this was the final end to the opportunity, or necessarily the decisive moment, but it was certainly a huge one. And one thing that they did to soften this a little bit was that the word had gone out, and in fact it was originally the thought that they would actually have the white people stay in the church building, and then they would be casting out the blacks. And you think about how important the church and a church building, that's very important. I think particularly important for African-American Christians. I think Daniels finally realized that, that wouldn't be a good idea. So let them have the building. I think that then prepared the way for something of a recovery, and opened, it meant that the opportunity that the Adventists had in Washington was not dead yet. But certainly it was dealt a huge and painful blow.
Now, how long did the evangelistic meetings of Sheaf and Washburn go on? How long were both of them evangelizing in Washington, D.C.?
Well, they both evangelized in 1902, and then Sheaf definitely in 1903. I don't know whether Washburn even did another campaign in 1903. And then after that, he didn't really do any further evangelism in Washington.
Okay, can you talk to us about I would characterize it as a one-sided competition? Did Sheaf think that he was in competition with Washburn? Or was it mainly on Washburn's side?
I think it was on Washburn's side, because Sheaf was having a success. He baptized, by my estimate, just comparing sources, nowhere is an exact number given, but it had to have been at least 10 to 15 white people. As a result of that 1902 campaign. Washburn, it seems, did not have any baptisms, or if he did, it was such a small number that he didn't even want to report it. I don't think that Sheaf was too concerned, but Washburn really felt betrayed and put down, and very quickly, right on the heels of this, you have the Review and Herald fire, December 1902. And now that is a spur to talk about relocation. Judson S. Washburn is the primary lobbyist to Ellen White and to W.C. White and to Daniels to come to Washington and Tacoma Park. Well, so now this heightens the drama, because what kind of church are we going to be in Washington, D.C., vis-a-vis race? And Washburn is mightily concerned. He comes right out and says, oh, yeah, they're going to have another big campaign in 1903, they being Sheaf and the First Church, and they'll grow. But that's not actually a good thing. because that's going to strengthen a wrong influence. So he is continually railing against Sheaf and trying to undermine his influence now vis-a-vis the move to Washington. Now there's maybe one other thing though that poisons the picture from the other side, and that is that Washburn does succeed. He puts down the initial, I think sometimes it's called earnest money. In other words, he sees a church building. He doesn't have the money, but he promises it. And then he tells Daniels, hey, I made this promise. I need the money now from the General Conference. Daniels kind of gives him like a little tap on the wrist. You really should have done that, but okay. But here's the problematic thing. They approved, the General Conference approved a $10,000 fundraising campaign. So the review, all of the union and conference papers, all, even they prevailed on Ellen White, the prophetess, to write a little piece for the review that would promote raising $10,000 for the Memorial Church. And the way it was presented and the way Washburn presented it, now that his congregation would sort of be the flagship for the church as it now moves its headquarters to Washington, it's all as if the other church doesn't even exist. But remember, it's much larger. It's much more successful. It's actually been doing real evangelism and bringing people in. But so it's like
Chief's church is it called the People's Church yet?
The People's Church has not come yet. It will very soon. But that's actually a different congregation.
Okay, so what is Chief's church called?
He's pastor of the First Church up until fall of 1903.
Sheaf is pastor of the First Church, and it's a mixed congregation.
Yes.
Washburn is pastor. What's the name of that church?
Memorial Church.
Memorial Church, and it's all white.
Yes. Yeah.
And Washburn wants that to be the official church of the General Conference once it gets to the city?
Oh, it's the representative church. In other words, yeah. He presents it as, well, the word Memorial Church.
Yeah.
That's the memorial for Seventh-day Adventism in Washington. And Washburn liked to talk about government and influencing the government. And he claims that he knew someone in the Secret Service, and he sort of had a hotline, so to speak, to President Roosevelt anytime he wanted, and this sort of thing. And he didn't put that in publication, but he put that in letters. Yeah. But he would write, Washburn was a good promoter. He was a talented man. And if you're not aware, in fact, I remember reading Washburn's stuff about the importance of Washington and how now, this will be an opportunity for us to present our message on a much broader stage, that also as we're dealing with the forces of religious oppression that want to, put in religious legislation, that we have to be, this will be a vantage point for countering the two-horned beast of Revelation 13 and so forth. I kind of like what he had to say. I thought it was impressive. But when you see the larger picture where he's just dismissing what in fact is a much larger work, and which also represents another kind of opportunity for a very impressive witness that, is being very much jeopardized, it gives you a whole different perspective.
Can you kind of share with us the correspondence between Washburn and Daniels and some of the things that Washburn said about Sheaf?
Okay, well, Washburn is continually complaining. He writes to Ellen White in June of 1903 when they're close to making a decision. And he writes these long letters giving all the reasons why this is the place. Don't go to New York. Come here. But then it's like, okay, we have a problem. that there is this church. He says they preach a political gospel. And by the way, Frederick Douglass's daughter, it is one of the members of that church. And he mentions Dr. Howard, who I guess we haven't brought on yet early, but he was a leading light, the pioneer of Black Adventism in Washington, D.C., a lay person, to be sure, but a spiritual leader of the highest order in my book. And it's filled with little Dr. Howard's, this congregation. And then he mentions Rosetta, not by name, but as Frederick Douglass's daughter. And by the way, Sister White, he says, Rosetta says that your advice not to intermarry is a wicked catering to Southern prejudice. So you see, what a lobbyist.
Well, because I mean, her father,
yes,
his second marriage was to a white woman.
Yeah.
But that was kind of personal for Rosetta Douglas Spread.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. But you see how Washburn is using it to poison Ellen and Willie White and A.G. Daniels. Now, I think that what you might also be thinking of is at a later point, when there is a break between the church and Sheaf, then Washburn writes to Daniels like an I told you so type of letter. Because what we should also say is that after being initially upset with Sheaf for siding with those who were criticizing the division of the church, Daniels starts to warm up to Sheaf pretty quickly. I mean, after all, what administrator can be too angry with somebody who's bringing in members?
Yep.
And he recognizes that this it's an extraordinary type of people that he is bringing in. Try to find a way to not sound elitist.
The way that they used to think back then.
Yeah, yeah. So these are professional people. They're educated people. They're high caliber people. Anyway, but of course, Daniels has his own agenda in mind. And so he encourages Sheaf to start another church. Don't build up the first church as one big, huge one, but that's where the People's Church comes in.
So why did he want Daniels to build up another church?
Sheaf, you mean, to build up another church?
Yeah, why did Sheaf want Daniels to build up another church? No. Why did Daniels want Sheaf to build up another church?
There you go. Well, I think that there are many reasons, but basically that is what Daniels envisioned all along. Now, Daniels decided to make his peace with the mixed race First Church. He's not going to attack them anymore. He's going to let them be. But he still wants to see Sheaf build up a black church. Well, now, in the meantime, how to explain all this succinctly. In the meantime, the First Church leaders, James Howard, the brilliant black doctor and eloquent letter writer, Andrew Kallstrom, the Swedish elder, also very strong letter writer, and someone who Daniel said, man, that Kallstrom has a will of iron. This was a formidable guy. They proposed for 1903 as a way to try to remedy the fiasco of the division of the church in the previous year. They said, yes, let us bring in a white, not Washburn, but let's bring in a strong white minister who actually be cooperative with Sheaf. And their plan was the initial contact, let us recognize the power of race, both to attract and repel, so that people will get to see a minister of their own race for both. But then when we bring them in, we will teach them that racial equality, treating one another equally, regarding each other as children of God, equal in his sight, that's part of what it means to be a Seventh-day Adventist. But the reason I explain that is to say that it kind of irritated Sheaf, because remember, Sheaf was used to preaching to white audiences. He had proven the previous summer that his evangelism would bring in people of both races. And so he was kind of ticked off at Howard and Kallstrom for suggesting that a white minister needed to be brought in to help him. So Daniels, helps explain why Sheaf agreed with Daniels' proposal. Strike out on your own now and build up a different congregation. Now, Sheaf never conceded that it was a black church. You know, in a way, it's kind of what the black Adventist churches have done all along. The black churches, the black conferences never closed to white people. We're not going to mimic that type of prejudice. So the People's Church, the name was chosen specifically to suggest an openness to all people. And according to A.T. Jones, there were some white members in the People's Church as well, but it's predominantly black. And that's why I call it the first major black urban Adventist congregation.
So what happened to First Church once Sheaf started the People's Church?
Well, it continued. It kind of lost a few members because I think some went over to the People's Church, but it continued as an interracial congregation for a few years yet. Now, gradually, by attrition and so forth, it eventually itself became a black church, but it rigorously rejected that categorization for at least another decade or so.
Now please give us the Odyssey. And before you go on, can you read that Washburn quote about Sheaf? Because I think that's very interesting.
Yeah. Well,
I can give you a second to get it if you need.
Okay.
A second to get the quote.
Yes. Okay. So I think the letter you're referring to is when Washburn is looking back a little bit, and he's narrating to Daniels how his perception of this whole interaction around about 1902 and 1903 was actually correct, that Daniels was wrong for trusting Sheaf and encouraging him to build up this other congregation, and to be supported, even to the extent that Daniels did support Sheaf. Washburn said, "Sheaf, I think, is a dangerous man. He attends the meetings of the colored agitators in Washington who advance the use of firearms and forcible resistance in order to claim their rights. And I told you, I believed that Sheaf believed in arming and fighting to kill when his people were threatened with lynching." Well, I'll just read. I mean, there's so much that could be said. Again, we're into a lot of alarmism, hyperbole, distortion. It's one thing to say, well, if there is a right to bear arms, it ought to be even across the races. And if somebody's attacking me, I have a right to defend myself. I have no doubt the Sheaf said that. But this stuff about, you know, fighting to kill when their rights are, you know, it's exaggerated. Yeah. Anyway, he goes on. He believes that Sheaf has been devious all along. And he says, "You have seen something." He's referring now to the members of the the black members of the congregation, you have seen something of their insolence and sullen looks. And I notice you say to Brother White that you would be sorry to have this people have mastery over you. That is true. The weaker you are, parenthesis, this is a very insecure man. The weaker you are, the more you realize what a terrible thing it would be to be under black government, under colored dominion. It looked...
Now this is J.S. Washburn. This is the evangelist that Daniels brought into Washington, D.C. to preach to the whites while Sheaf was preaching to the blacks.
Right. And,
okay, and now Washburn is writing to A.G. Daniels.
Yes.
Okay.
And he is writing at a point at which there has been a break between Sheaf and Daniels and the organized work. And basically he's saying, I told you so. And here's how I saw it. Because as I was explaining earlier, for a few years from 1903 up to about 1905 or six, Daniels and Sheaf did work together. And in fact, Daniels told Washburn, oh, just stop with all that racial stuff. But now Washburn is sort of narrating these past events that exactly as you realize, and he's talking about his perceptions. Well, there is a lot here. Let me come down to something that, well, there's so much, but eventually I'll get to something that I think will be quite a new thing because I, for whatever reason, chose not to include it in the book. He says that he looks into Sheaf's eyes and they're kind of shifty. They made me feel uncomfortable. And that, I believe, is the real index of his character. Comes down to the fact that Sheaf did, I think it's fair to say that Sheaf had a bit of a problem with his temper, probably not that much more than most of us, but sometimes he got upset about things. And he, you know.
Doc, are you quoting?
I'm setting up.
Okay.
Sorry.
Okay.
Yeah. I'm trying to explain the background to this.
Okay.
Is the fact that Sheaf does have this trait, you know, of showing anger at times. Well, that's kind of normal, actually. But anyway, here is what Washburn said just before we divided the church. Okay, so now this is September 1902. I had a straight talk with him once. And the man looked positively venomous. And I thought if I should have to meet this black fellow in the depths of the African forest, and he had had his war paint on and feathers in his wool and a white cloth about 2 feet long around his waist, I should certainly have been frightened at the look on his face, as it was talking in my from my room at 14th Street, I felt safe as far as personal injury was concerned. But this man looked positively dangerous.
So the correspondence often illuminates what other sources do not.
Yes.
And with Washburn, it becomes about black autonomy, black rule, and just pure racism, or I should say sullied and dirty racism.
Yeah.
Just the basest of racism.
Yeah.
And this can really be read into Washburn's behavior and his disposition toward Sheaf.
Yeah.
These are the worst black tropes. of the jungle, of primitiveness, of heathen, of danger.
Yeah.
All right, Doc. Talk to us about, please, the odyssey of the People's Church and how they ended up leaving the denomination and then coming back.
Right. Okay. So the People's Church was organized in December 1903 at a meeting first at a rented room in the True Reformers Hall, which was kind of it had been recently built with entirely black labor from the architect all the way through. So it was kind of point of pride for the Washington black community. But that's an aside, really. But it one way it's significant is that it's right down there on U Street in Washington, D.C. And that, you know, near Howard University, that was the center of black culture in Washington, D.C. And they had about 45 members initially, but they grow pretty steadily up to 150. In 2020, that may not seem all that impressive, but that's pretty large numbers for Adventism at that.
Just the black Adventists in the city were probably about 10% of all of black Adventists.
Yes. If you include the People's Church and then the black membership at the First Church. Yeah. So, they need a building. And, you know, I really have to credit Sheaf for trying to work with the brethren, trying to work with the system as best he could. They set up a committee. By the way, for those who are aware and connected and thinking about church organization and how that works, from 1903 to 1909, because of this volatile race situation, the churches in Washington and Tacoma Park were put directly under the General Conference. There was something called a district committee. And especially for the first part of that, Daniels basically was running that. There was another chairman, but Daniels had his hands on all of this. All right. Well, so they set up a committee, you know, like a search committee. And, help Brother Sheaf here find a location, find a church. But somehow, Sheaf would find a prospect, but the schedules wouldn't line up. And so finally he got fed up with that. And he, because of the reception that he had received in the black community, generally, you know, he had this amazing skill to be very clear and definite about what he was preaching, about the Seventh-day Adventist message, and he didn't baptize people unless they thoroughly accepted it. But at the same time, he did not alienate the rest of, the black community in general, and so was a highly regarded figure in the community. And he was able to get financial help, I think, both in the form of a donation, but also loans, favorable terms for loans, plus from his membership. And they arrange entirely on their own a very to purchase a very well-suited building at 10th and V, all right, UV Street Northwest. Again, it's right in the heart of the cultural heart of Black Washington. Mm-hmm. And so now Sheaf is, and he and Daniels have been working the correspondence in throughout 1904 is really quite friendly, end of 1903 throughout 1904. But now in 1905, they have, People's Church has their building. They financed entirely on their own, but they are going to be very hard pressed to keep up the payments, to do it all on their own. Plus, remember, the denomination had just gotten behind fundraising $10,000 for Washburn's church, the Memorial Church. And so Sheaf is saying, are you going to do anything? Are you going to help us? Not just with the church building, that was part of it. But then you have the whole issue of the education and health work that, as we were talking about earlier, was of such great importance to Sheaf and to the People's Church. Congregation of 150, you started to have some young people that want to take nurses training, for example. You have people who want to be treated at an Adventist sanitarium. So will this church have an equal access, an equal shot at those kinds of institutions that Adventists excel at? First on the building, nothing from the GC. Daniels later admitted that he blew it in this regard, because it was just such a glaring contrast. Here you had somebody who really did not bring in any new members. He took some from the original Washington church, and then when the GC moved, well, that built up his congregation. And here you have somebody who is evangelizing with
unprecedented... Washburn, and now you have Sheaf.
Yeah, Sheaf, on the other hand, evangelizing with unprecedented success, has built up an entirely new congregation with 150 members, and you're not even going to give them some help for their building? And so you can sense it in the correspondence that Sheaf is starting to get a little more testy. And finally, in June of 1905, they're ready to dedicate this new church building, the People's Church. They haven't paid it off, but they're ready for the formal, introductory ceremony and dedication of it as a place of Seventh-day Adventist congregation's worship. And, Sheaf says to Daniels in a letter, I really need to know, does the conference intend to do anything? Because the people are starting to ask me hard questions. And so Daniels really does not have anything more than kind of vague. Well, maybe, we got to pay for this and that. We got to take care of this and that. And then maybe we'll deal with the needs of the People's Church. Well, at the same time, then you have Washington Training College, as it was initially called. Then it was a Foreign Missionary and Training Seminary, but you have higher educational institution in Tacoma Park, today's Washington Adventist University. The Washington Sanitarium is under development. There is a smaller operation in the city. It won't be until 1907, I believe, that the Washington Sanitarium actually opens. But everybody knows about it. It's being built up. And so Sheaf and others from the First Church and the People's Church, in the fall of 1905, they also kind of become a little bit more sharp in saying, look, at least can we open some treatment rooms, what they called for kind of small clinics in Washington that could be for our people. It's nothing happening. So as we get into 1906, Sheaf and his congregation, his allies, so to speak, decide we have to bring this matter to a point of decision, an either or. And so
if I could very quickly just read this. This is what the People's Church, this is what Sheaf's church stated in a petition around this time to the General Conference, quote, "We desire to give the whole message in our day and generation, but we find ourselves handicapped in that we have no schools, hospitals, or sanitariums under our control, or to the best of our knowledge, for our use." Right. And they also say, well, their whole goal, the People's Church's whole goal, is to give the Adventist message holistically, because you're mentioning health.
Yes.
Holistically to the Black population of Washington, D.C.
Right.
They see themselves as being hindered from this because they're getting no GC support or very little.
Right. And one thing that they also say in there as to why they can't wait, in other words, why this is an urgent matter, is that the work is finishing. It's drawing to a close. Mm-hmm. We got to get the message to Black people. We can't sit around and you know, wait for some gradual thing. And we're going to be greatly hindered if the whole message, you know, in all of its beneficial dimensions, is not something that can be shared by Black people. So the alternative that they propose in this, I think it's a petition. I call it a petition. It's in the form of a letter, but it's from the People's Church, is that if we're not going to be allowed access to the sanitarium and school in Tacoma Park, is it, can you point us to an alternative? Or if there is no other alternative, could you allow us to retain our tithes and offerings so that we can finance this for ourselves?
Yep.
Now, so of course that is goes against Seventh-day Adventist polity, the Seventh-day Adventist form of church government, very important for the unity of the church. But I would suggest to you that one reason why Daniels felt he had to take a hard line on not even countenancing anything like that was that the Kellogg crisis is coming to a head. And the perception at that point, and to a degree the reality, was that Kellogg was trying to set up a counter-Adventism in Battle Creek. He's trying to peel off as many congregations as he can. And so, you know, that's part of the reason for a very hard line that was taken. Now, as far as the admission to the Tacoma Park institutions, it was very evasive. And, you know, I read this over and over, and I try to think of some construction that I could put on it that makes some sense, other than it was just the most transparently disingenuous piece of reasoning that no thinking person could be convinced by, because what the response was is, well, as to the question of the policies of these institutions, we must point out to you, this is General Conference President writing on behalf of the General Conference Committee, that these are separate institutions. They have their own boards. They will decide. But anybody could see that the General Conference officers were also the same people who were chairing those institutions. So he says, why don't you form a committee and we'll discuss what we might do, you know. But
this is when, Doc, if I can say something very quickly, this is when or where the systemic racism starts to come to the fore.
I think so.
Because in 1901 and 1903, you had the reorganization.
Right.
And just the very nature that Blacks were not represented
right
in that reorganization. They didn't have a department. They didn't have leadership. We see when the Negro department comes later in 1909, there is, for the first 10 years, there's a white director of the Negro department. So literally, blacks have no representation in leadership, in the structure, so they're forgotten.
Yes.
Their concerns are not represented at all.
Right.
And this is when it really becomes clear why a Negro department's needed, and later why regional conferences or black administered conferences are needed. There's no representation. When you don't have representation, the work, no one cares about the black work. Monies don't go to the black work. I mean, they literally get embezzled and frauded away from the black work. And all of the tithes and offerings that blacks give are funneled to other institutions that care nothing about the black work.
Right.
Or little.
Right. Yeah. So, Pat, I mean, maybe just moving, fast forwarding a little bit to how this came out, there was some intervening events, but February 1907, a series of meetings, but right in there, is when the People's Church declares its independence, that we will no longer be governed by the General Conference. And so they continued to be Seventh-day Adventist, use the Sabbath School Quarterly. There's really no doctrinal issue involved. But now you have an independent Seventh-day Adventist congregation. Yes. And everything is in an uproar. Sheaf is still looked to as the great leader of Black Adventism. Well, what will the other Black ministers do? Will First Church go along? And
this is right in the nation's capital, right on the General Conference, their doorstep. Can you speak a little bit about Sheaf and Ellen White?
Okay. All right. Yes, comes in here.
She writes a total of two or three letters to him.
I'm only aware of her actually writing one.
Just one. Okay.
She
mentions him in some other places.
She does mention him. And when she and Willie came to Washington in 1904, and she stayed there for a few months, kind of to shepherd and guide this process of development of this new Adventist center, she came by, and he reported to her on his work. And she wrote to one of her workers back in California at Elms Haven, very positive terms, how wonderful it is. The Sheaf is baptizing all these people, and 14 more were going to be baptized next Sabbath, and that she's going to speak there. She agreed to speak there. In another place that I didn't find for the book, but when the Ellen White correspondence went online, I found her referring to 1902 at an organizational meeting of the Southern Union, very important event in and of itself, but I won't go into all of that. But she does refer to Sheaf speaking, and she said it was excellent. Now, she's not someone who, she didn't want to lavish praise on ministers very much, right? So meaningful that that she too recognized that this was, there was a gift at work here. But she sends a testimony to Sheaf really right after this declaration of independence on the part of his congregation has already taken place. It's so interesting from so many angles. Yeah. But basically her message to him was, stay away from Kellogg, stay away from Battle Creek. Again,
and Battle Creek is a synecdoche for the Kellogg Jones axis.
Exactly, A.T. Jones become part of that, and again, because of the rebuff from the General Conference with regard to Tacoma Park, then she says, well, you know, Kellogg has said he'll take our students. So he goes out to Battle Creek to kind of pursue this and to kind of see if, well, they've really said they're saying terrible things about Kellogg. Is it true? So he's going to kind of investigate for himself. So that takes priority in Ellen White's letter, her testimony to him, along with that demon spiritual pride that everybody struggles with, also then manifested in a souring of relationships with his wife, Annie, a distancing there. And it has been pulled out, you know, in compilations, I forget which one, Adventist Home or whatever, compilations on marriage counsels for married couples and how you ought to speak kindly to your spouse and so forth. But
that's what she wrote to Sheaf.
Yeah.
Sheaf made the compilations.
Oh, yes, right, yes. But, it, you know, contextless as it used to be. Sure. Let's just pull that. Yeah. And so it's interesting. On the one hand, she doesn't have anything to say. She's not concerned about the organizational details. At least she doesn't speak of those other than avoid the Kellogg influence. She has no words of rebuke for his civil rights activities. I don't know how much to make of that. You know.
Now, what year did she write him?
This was 1907, right at the point where the break.
But it hadn't happened yet.
Actually, it had.
But by when she wrote it, it hadn't happened yet.
Yeah, it was in there were two decisive meetings and one of them had already taken place, but she says, stop right where you are.
Right.
It's a little ambiguous actually as to where he actually was at that point, but I probably it's fair to say that in her mind, she perceived it. That what she means is stop this drift away from the organized work.
And doesn't she have a vision about Sheaf? Doesn't she say, I was shown or something to that effect?
Well,
maybe not in that letter, but in another place.
No. At the very beginning, she starts out. And here, I think we should get the exact words. After all, we are quoting Ellen White. Perhaps you should pause. Ellen White starts out this testimony to Elder Sheaf with these words. I am writing to you in the early morning. In the night season, I have had representations of your case and have been conversing with some of the brethren in Washington, D.C. in regard to the work to be done in the city.
See, that's a vision indicator. When she says in the night season, I was shown representations, that's visionary language.
Yes.
Yeah.
But she had a real problem right from the beginning, because after she says representations of in the night season and have been conversing with some of the brethren in Washington, D.C. He took that, he says, wow, she hasn't heard my side.
Yeah.
Daniels said, no. She saw the conversations in vision. And he tried to, he even wrote to Willie White and to Ellen White herself, saying that this is what you meant, right? When you said that, Sister White, you were saying that you saw the conversations in vision. They didn't say anything, which is, you know, it's like, okay, we're not going to lie, but we're not going to deny it. I am out of this, may be a little rough to take, but
W. C. White and A. G. Daniels both had Ellen White's ear.
Yes, yes. And so I think that that now, you know, one could say, well, if an individual is so disposed to resist a testimony that comes through the servant of the Lord, they'll find a reason. And I don't discount that, but I do feel that Daniels, you know, was being manipulative, yeah, almost Jesuitical in his reasoning here. Yeah. Anyway, that's one reason why Sheaf did not, in quotes, accept the testimony, in a sense that it did not lead him, at least at that point, to reconcile with the denomination.
If I can just say a word here, because Daniel says in April 1906 that, quote, we must hold this colored element with the stiff rein, and in brackets, and not allow them to, quote, frighten us and press us to their terms. Now, Sheaf is what could be considered, to use the parlance of the day, an uppity Negro. Mm-hmm. An uppity Negro. Mm-hmm. Early Adventist leadership, and Christian leadership for that matter, they were okay with Black workers and the Black work, as long as they stayed in their perceived place.
Yes.
But when Sheaf showed some background, some backbone, as G.I. Butler, erstwhile G.C. president, former G.C. president, would say, Negro independence.
Yes.
Negro independence, that's what he said. They had a problem with him.
Yes.
They had a problem with him. It's almost like, we appreciate the Black work as long as it stays contained,
right,
and it is subservient to us.
Right.
Now, when we talk about Adventists and race, this is vitally important.
Right.
Because Adventists were abolitionists. Adventists were against lynchings. They were against Jim Crowism. They were against debt slavery. Yeah. All of these things. But when a Negro tried to assert independence and equality with them,
right,
with many of them, that was a different story.
Right.
Then you see a species of racism come out.
Yes.
It's like, we don't want Blacks being enslaved. We don't want Blacks being lynched. But if they try to be on equality with us,
equality of leadership and power, right?
Well, even a bit of Black autonomy, because Sheaf wasn't trying to take away the GC presidency from A.G. Daniels.
Right.
He wasn't trying to, but there was a degree of autonomy, a degree of independence, a degree of actualization.
Right.
That was too much. And so this is when quotes like these, we must keep a stiff rein, keep them, yes, on our own terms. Statements like Butler's Negro independence,
right,
it makes me even think that they wanted to constrain the Black work, as it were, so that it would not have too much of a spike and that there wouldn't be too many Black members, because Black membership in many ways meant Black power. It represented an expansion of their delegacy, an expansion of their constituency. And so they're fine as long as they are contained. And to me, in the person of Lewis Sheaf and later James K. Humphrey, they saw a black person that could not be contained.
Yes.
And that was a threat. That was intimidating to them. And yes. They could not handle it.
Yes. I think so. I think Daniels is, I think this probably lies too deep for Daniels to be conscious of. In other words, to be really very self-aware about. That quote that you read is very revealing, and it is, you could almost see it, oh, he's right with Butler. But I think if you look at the whole picture, Daniels is torn between people like Butler and Washburn who have been attacking him for supporting Chief at all.
Yeah.
And Daniels feels self-righteous, or he feels that he has done the virtuous thing, and he has risked to support Chief, and now Chief has betrayed him. But he cannot, I think that he cannot see how there isn't, that the assumption that he is being driven by is that he is in charge. And the idea, as you stated, of the black leadership of having some autonomy, that just didn't, I think that was sort of inconceivable, or he was unable to really to see that as an incriminating dynamic, because the only thing that he admitted upon reflection was that that it was unfair about the money supporting Washburn and then not supporting Chief. He recognized that was wrong, but he did not. And I remember, as you said earlier, all of this is leading up to the organization of the Negro Department, but got to have a white man in charge, 1909. We can't actually, go so far as to even give that much of a standing to a black minister at that point.
So Doc, tell us about the odyssey of the People's Church. They left in January, in 1907, January 1907.
Yes.
And they would come back, right?
Yes, yes. Well, there is a fascinating dance that's going on, because a lot of people in the People's Church, and a lot of people in the General Conference circles, they don't want this to happen. They're not happy at all. I mean, even Washburn, who was the most venomous in his views of Chief, at certain points had to admit, that guy's an incredible preacher. Washburn said, he was so spirit-filled, I was scared. So anyway, what I'll try to focus it here, and that is that there's talk back and forth, and you have W.H. Green and Sidney Scott.
Also, one more thing. Yeah. Washburn also said about Chief, quote, "Chief is too much for the ordinary colored man."
Right, right. So yes, he had, just by virtue of his charisma, his intelligence, his independent mindedness, in Washburn's mind, any black that comes into his sphere of influence, they'll be crushed. They'll be sucked into this, terrible influence. But Sidney Scott, W.H. Green, these are up and coming Adventist, black Adventist ministers, and they're trying to broker a reconciliation. First Scott tries, and then Green tries.
Chief in the People's Church.
Right, to bring them back together. And Chief tries to get some support from other black Adventist ministers, but he really doesn't. He ends up really failing to. First Church, it was on the brink of joining with the People's Church, but Dr. Howard, who we mentioned briefly before, really felt that it was essential to stay with the organized work, even if and no set of leaders owns the work. They may make terrible mistakes, and he felt that they did, they had, and they, you know, they did. But he was the influence that kept the first church as sort of a dissident force, but within the organized work. But anyway, so but Sheaf is really not succeeding then in what he had sort of thought and envisioned. I think that he thought that the other black ministers would rally around him, at least several of them. He went to visit Humphrey. He went to visit his old friend. I don't think we ever mentioned the fact that Buster, J.R. Buster, was his first evangelism partner. And he went to visit a few others, but none of them really would join him. So there's kind of a stalemate in that way, and also in the sense that the People's Church really is not, itself is really not growing and prospering the way Sheaf had hoped. So he's beginning to rethink it. In the meantime, his wife has died, and his daughter, Clara, has died. It's tuberculosis.
Clara is in December of 1907, and Annie, his wife, is March 1908, and both right. TB.
Right, right. So a woman by the name of Lucy Wetzel, whose husband had died, but had met Sheaf in Chattanooga when she was working at what they call the Helping Hand Mission, and he was preaching two summers there. And she, you know, her husband was alive at that time, so he knew them both. But somehow, and then Lucy was setting up a school. She was teaching a school under the umbrella of the Southern Missionary Society, I believe. But somehow then they came into contact with each other, and it was the rumor mill was that Lucy said, "I'm going to make a real Seventh-day Adventist out of him again." So there's that factor. They get married in Alabama, Madison County, Alabama, where Lucy is attending she's like a Bible worker. She's attending this institute.
They were in Huntsville.
Yeah, yeah. And Sheaf is lurking around somewhere, and you know, the white man who's Hazmer, who's leading the Negro department at this point, he sends a letter and says, "Yeah, I hear Sheaf's gonna be there, and I don't know exactly what's going on, but you know what a shifty character he is." So it turns out all he was there to do was to get married. He didn't have anything to do with what's going on. But I sort of narrate that to say that I think that there is something to Lucy's influence,
yeah,
in the combination of factors. And finally, you see, what Sheaf had been holding out for in these talks over the past 5 or 6 years was, you need to show something tangible first.
Yeah.
And then we'll think about coming back. But Daniel said, "No way, I'm not going to make, you know, a congregation being part of the body contingent on something like that." He just, but so anyway, Sheaf drops that sort of precondition.
Doug, but a couple of things, if I can assert a couple of things, because you mentioned 1909, uh-huh. May 1909, the establishment of the Negro Department.
Right.
This is Sheaf's influence.
Oh, yes.
I'm not going to say totally, but it is Sheaf's influence. So Sheaf is having a systemic
right
influence on the church.
Right.
And one more thing, when we look at Sidney Scott, when we look at Matthew Strawn and W.H. Green, Green really presses Sheaf to come back. And he is, and just to give the mindset of some of the Black Adventist ministers, this is Sidney Scott. He says, "Color and truth are two different things. Color is skin deep. Truth is everlasting. any movement which hath color as its reason for separating from the body has a foundation too shallow to stand the test. Color is color and truth is truth.
Right.
So many of these early Black ministers, in fact, was it James Howard who said, I am Adventist first, then I'm Black?
Yeah, he had said that at an earlier time, but I think it has definite bearing.
So this is the mindset. Their loyalty, many of them, their loyalty is to Adventism before color, because they see truth as deeper than color.
Yeah. Now, there's a lot of complication to that. But one thing that has to be said, though, is that they also use that loyalty as a leverage. In other words, yes, we're loyal, but look, if you don't want the same thing that happened with Sheaf of the People's Church to happen again, or if you want us, you know, if you want growth in the Black sector, then something's going to have to happen.
Yeah.
And so that's part of the way Sheaf can be seen as the, you know, it can be credited, the formation of the department could be credited to him, because even though it, you know, it was only a partial step at best, it was something. And, several of the Black Adventist ministers wrote a petition and asked for this, but you can see right in the language that they used to say that, you know, if we're going to have any kind of viability among the Black population in America, something has to happen.
Okay, so People's Church is reconciled with the denomination in May 1913.
Yes.
How did they come back?
Well, Sheaf had to go before the General Conference and do a mea culpa. In other words, we were wrong. We were wrong about asserting congregational
authority.
Authority and independence.
Yeah.
And, he gives a very moving speech about how I believe that this message is for all my people. I believed it when I first embraced it. I believe it now. He says, I think maybe something like this happened, like Moses rose up and tried to kill the Egyptian and tried to take things into his own hands, and God had to send him to the wilderness to teach him a lesson. Well, maybe something like that has happened. It's interesting that I don't say this in a critical way to say he was egotistical, but it does show us a Sheaf's self-conception as a liberator for his people, you know,
which was a trope in the Black community.
Yeah. So that's why I say I'm not trying to make some big deal out of it as a being grandiose, but it shows why he cared as much as he did about Adventism, and that it was worth going through all of this and then giving it another try. Yeah. Now, part of the condition was, though, that he would go somewhere else. And he ended up in Los Angeles, California.
Los Angeles in a gilded era time for Black Adventism. This is the start.
Yes.
Black Adventism in, and this is the, as I said, the Forrest Gump aspect of Sheaf. He's in these critical places at critical times.
Yes.
So around this time, you have Jenny Ireland, you have Theodore Troy, you have Annie Temple. Is that the name of Ruth Temple's mother?
Amy Temple, I think.
Amy Temple.
Yeah.
You have the efflorescence, the origins of Adventism in Los Angeles, the Furlong Tract Church.
Yes.
Watts. And Sheaf is there. And this is an underrated part of his ministry, probably because it was ill-fated, right, Doc?
Yes, it was. And it's, you know, it's just like, to me, it's I do get emotionally involved in this story. And it's like, you, even though you know the outcome, even when I'm working through it, it's like, oh, come on, why can't this work out? It seems that at least the surface issue now is the authority of Ellen White. So she goes there in 1913, and for about a year, a little more than a year, things seem to be going pretty well.
He starts the Berean Church, right?
He starts the Berean Church, and he comes into the Furlong Church, but then he also starts another one, Watts, as well. At least he's pastoring that. Now, those are both Berean and Watts are small, but still, he is accomplishing things in his evangelistic work initially. But there is a change in the presidency of the Southern California Conference. I cannot say for sure the significance of that, but it does seem to correlate with the beginnings of his problems. Now, this was also 1915. Ellen White by the time what I'm about to narrate with regard to Sheaf reaches its fruition, she has passed away. And there's
just a couple hundred miles north.
Yeah.
Sheaf in Elmshaven,
yeah,
right?
Yeah. But there's denomination-wide angst about the authority of the prophet and what will happen after she has passed away.
And this is before, obviously before the 1919 conference, when the denominational ministers would sort of hash out their feelings about Ellen White's inspiration and try to come to some common ground about it.
Yes.
So I mean, I agree that there is considerable angst.
Yeah, yeah. Now, Volume 9 of the Testimonies, which has a famous or infamous section.
Yes.
Council on Race Relations. It came out in 1909. Chronology is important here. Sheaf is reconciled to the denomination in 1913. And in fact, part of that, I never see it in his words, but W.H. Green reports it. He has said, yes, he will use the spirit of prophecy more. And in fact, I've heard him use Desire of Ages even in some of his sermons and so forth. I'm saying this to say that the reconciliation was worked out with Volume 9 already there. But somehow it becomes an issue in Southern California. Now, there is a very interesting work about Black Los Angeles. And you, I think you know the one I'm talking about. And I'm trying to find the name of the scholar who wrote this book. Flaming is his name, Douglas Flaming. And he points out that at this time, California was kind of a battleground between people who were immigrating from the South and the people who are immigrating from the North. So race relations are kind of up for grabs in a way. And there's a lot more freedom in California and a lot more sort of fluidity and openness, but it's endangered.
Yeah.
So I think that is a significant part of the picture as well, because somehow Sheaf is being pressed to affirm the inspiration of and his acceptance of everything that's written in Volume 9 of the Testimonies, such as, yes, we have many talented Black workers who can accomplish much, but for many reasons, a white man must lead. And that, no agitation for equality.
Which, by the way, that first quote was a major justification for A.J. Haysmer.
Yeah.
Being director of the Negro Department.
Right. Yeah. And Sheaf is confused. I think maybe just about everybody who's read Volume 9 of the Testimonies, even internally, but then when you set it next to the section of Volume 7 on race, when you set it alongside the Southern work, especially the call to our duty to the colored people, and you know these ringing affirmations of principle and equality and so forth, and then you see some of these it's like a patchwork of things that she has said here and there, and the context is not explained, and she says this is like a Chinese puzzle. And he refuses to say that he accepts this as inspired authoritative writing. He just will not do that.
In fact, he says that she didn't write it.
Yes.
This is
quite interesting, because that's what he says. Well, it's a letter jointly signed by this Mr. and Mrs. Sheaf. Okay, so Lewis and Lucy to Elder Daniels in October of 1915. And it's kind of like, it's very respectful and almost affectionate. And they're saying, well, here's what has happened. And so we're going to try to get work with the YMCA or something like that. But it's almost like a farewell.
So they voluntarily resigned.
From the
Southern California Conference.
They withdrew. The Berean Church did the same thing that the People's Church in Washington. They withdrew. So
they withdrew. The church withdrew before Sheaf resigned.
I don't know that there was a resignation, but there was a separation. That after about 9 meetings with the conference committee, then. Sheaf and his wife, remember his wife was the one who wanted to make him a real Seventh-day Adventist, but she's fed up too now. But it's a complicated picture, because remember, you have the people in the Furlong Church, you have the Temples, the Troys, and so forth, and they don't go with Sheaf. Yep. But anyway, I wanted to just say that it is a bit of a puzzle for Sheaf and the Sheafs to say to Elder Daniels in October 1915, we were willing to say nothing about it, Volume 9, and I believe that. And then furthermore, we don't believe that the dear Sister White actually wrote those things. But already in September, Black newspapers throughout the nation were running stories about the Chicago Defender, Seventh-day Adventist Lewis Race Elder. And you have Sheaf tearing into these difficult statements and really kind of, understandably, but from a viewpoint, which, was widely shared at the time, that was very literalistic, and this kind of a rigid view of something that obviously is not an eternal truth statement. If she's inspired, why would she say that? And so it's a pretty strong attack.
Now, let me ask you this. Do you think Sheaf here is operating from a place of good faith? He has these notions of racial unity and integration, and Ellen White's counsel is cutting crosswise, at least as an expedient or a temporary expedient. Or do you think that he has issues from the past with her and the church?
I think it's all of that and more.
Yeah.
It's complicated. It does seem to me, and there are documents that are alluded to in some of the documents I did find that I couldn't find those other documents. They just weren't, you know, in the archives. So it's frustrating to have an incomplete picture. But it does seem that the conference was pressing him unduly.
Yeah.
In a very literalistic and authoritarian way, and forcing him, and I think it does. I take their word that they were willing not to agitate it themselves and go on. We're happy to go on without even talking about it, but that wasn't good enough. On the other hand,
they were saying to him, publicly state that you accept Testimonies Volume 9.
Yeah, basically.
And the Council on the Color Line. And they were they were pushing him. They were pushing that on him.
Yes. They needed from him as such a centrally significant, influential top black minister in Southern California, they needed him to affirm that he accepted Volume 9 fully as inspired, authoritative. And so that's pretty, that's pretty rigorous. And I think that he had not been pressed so hard in 1913. Again, there's this unfolding of, there's a back and forth here that gets confusing, but 1913, somehow he's acceptable and he's willing to reconcile himself to the denomination. Volume 9 is already there. But 2 years later, two or three years later, suddenly he's being pressed in a way that apparently he hadn't been before. In other words, they weren't satisfied with just some general affirmation, but they're pressing him hard. But it does seem there's a little bit of double talk, because on the one hand you say, oh, we think Sister White has the gift of prophecy, but we don't think that she said these things, when you have already lambasted her in the press before the letter went out. But that's kind of a side point. I think that there is another point, though, and that is that there must have been a reason why, both in this instance and others, that she really didn't get more of the Black Adventists to follow along with him. So you think of these people at the Furlong Tract Church, and very little, they didn't go with him. We should maybe
say that by this time, it seems as if his charisma was waning a little bit.
Possibly. Could we pause, though, for just a minute? Because...
All right, so Sheaf ends up, after he resigns and the Berean Church chooses to leave the denomination, Sheaf teams up with Jonathan W. Manns.
John W. Manns, yes, sir.
Can you talk a little bit about Manns and the Free Seventh-day Adventist Church?
Yes, well, Manns was a very effective evangelist in Florida, mainly in the South, and then he went to Savannah, Georgia, and he again was very successful there in building up a Black Adventist congregation. They acquired a nice church on their own. There, he even had some businesses going, grocery store, and so he is a very strong Black Adventist leader. But the Georgia Conference then says, we need the title to that church that you just paid for, you know? And so he says, no, that's not going to happen.
Yeah.
So according to Lucy Sheaf, or according to an account, that was sent from Andros, the Pacific Union president. It was actually Lucy Schief that just sort of shouted out at one of these, not one of the meetings with the conference committee, but at a meeting of the Black Adventists in Southern California, where this thing is all coming to a head now, and what direction are we going to go? And Lucy said, "We are free Seventh-day Adventists." She just sort of exclaimed that. And that seems to be the origin of this name. Well, Schief, exactly how the connection was made, I'm not sure, but he went to Savannah in the spring of 1916. So this would be a few months later. And the Savannah Tribune, which is a excellent black newspaper, announces a new denomination. Schief and Manns now are starting a new denomination of Free Seventh-day Adventists.
But the Free Seventh-day Adventists, they acknowledge Manns as the founder.
Well, now we're getting into, there are a couple of groups current today that, might want to argue some points on this. But I believe that Schief, as so far as I can tell, the Berean church that we talked about and Lucy Wetzel, in fact, actually where I saw this was in a narrative in the Savannah paper, that's where the name came from. And that then they together formed the Free Seventh-day Adventists as a denomination in April 1916.
Even though it was about congregational sovereignty, right?
Yes, but they are wanting to form a network of churches, and the polity is that's an interesting question. Not sure about that, but I think the main thing though is actually black independence or autonomy.
A square deal for the Negro.
Exactly. Sure. I think Schief was he had been a Baptist. I think that the congregational polity was what he knew. It's what he was comfortable about. But it was not the issue for him, and I don't think it was for Manns either. It was about, this gross unfairness when it comes to issues of finance and decision making.
Yeah.
We buy a church. And now you want the title, especially in view of everything that has happened. And I.H. Evans, who was the secretary,
treasurer.
Yeah, he writes a letter saying, the colored people acquire nice buildings for themselves, and then we turn around and try to give them he called it a cheap John proposition. In other words, if they're getting their church building through the conference, it's a cheap, inferior thing. But if they do it,
John, as in J-O-H-N?
Yeah.
Is that prostitution language? What is that?
I don't think so. But I don't know what he meant. Cheap John. It could be that the GC or the conference structure does not pay out much. But his point simply was that if the colored people, if they go through the conference, they get a lousy church, but if they do it themselves, they get a nice one. I mean, he was just acknowledging that this type of thing had happened. But Schief and Manns do not stay in alliance very long at all. They had a big campaign planned for Jacksonville. In 1917, I think it was, Schief actually started a school, a short-lived school with Lucy in Jacksonville. But they went their separate ways. And so that's why Manns is much more prominently associated with the Free SDA. And so here you really do have racial schism. You have a separate Black Adventist denomination that actually does have a few years of viability. Congregations in the South, Costa Rica, Jamaica, I would say even more than the later J.K. Humphrey United Seventh Day Adventists.
Yeah.
This was probably the most, most solid organization. But after Mann's died in 1929, then they kind of started to fade.
Now, how did Mann's die?
Well, I don't know. But he went to Costa Rica and he died. I'm not trying to be silly about it.
It was a tragic death, wasn't it?
Yeah, but I think the inevitable DeWitt Williams found his, or maybe it was someone else, found the death certificate, and there's no, it's not really that revealing. I'd have to check again to see what the disease was, but
okay,
you know, there have been rumors about it, but
yeah.
He was young. He was like maybe 50. If he was 50, he wasn't much more than 50.
Okay. Now, how does Sheaf end up back in D.C. at the People's Church?
Well,
he has a meeting with Jones and Cini, right?
Yeah. The People's Church kind of on its own, although very much in the sort of general sympathy with Sheaf, but they on their own again withdraw from the conference because really basically over the same issues. But Sheaf is not actually there at that point. He does come in the summer of 1916, and technically the People's Church is still part of the District of Columbia Conference, which had been set up in 1909. And A.T. Jones was a member. Technically, he had worked his way back into Seventh-day Adventist membership, even when the General Conference had put out notice everywhere, do not allow A.T. Jones into your churches and your fellowship. And then right under their noses, he becomes a member of what constitutionally was a Seventh-day Adventist congregation, but the break was already kind of in motion. But Sheaf goes to Jacksonville, as I said, but that venture seems to have failed. So in 1918, he comes back to be pastor of the People's, still called Seventh-day Adventist, for about 5 years,
and it's a part of the General Conference.
No, it by 1917, the second and final break,
yeah,
was implemented fully, but they still
had left the church in L.A. and he goes to Georgia, goes to Jacksonville, then he returns to D.C. to pastor the People's Church. And it's not a Seventh-day Adventist church.
It's not connected to the conference.
Yeah.
But I also think it's significant that it still called itself Seventh-day Adventist.
Yep.
For a few more years. And I think for a while, Sheaf was still somehow trying to live out a independent Adventism, but gradually I think although he retained his belief in the seventh day Sabbath, he never surrendered that. I think that he gradually just became not so interested in having some kind of alternative Adventism, and so eventually they connect with the Seventh Day Baptists in 1926.
Now tell me about, well, when did Sheaf stop pastoring the People's Church?
Well, there was the interval from 1913 to, I guess it would be 1918. And then he came back till he died in 1938, he was pastor of the People's church.
Ah, what would you say? What would you say the membership was like? Like how many members roughly?
Yeah, I think it was around 100, okay. And it I don't get the sense that it was growing though. However, she continues to be a widely lauded orator and community leader. He's given talks at the YMCA or the Bethel Literary and Culture Society, which was the place where the Black intelligentsia had their forum. Du Bois, Washington, all Randolph, Chief, all in the same. By the way, and Rogers as well, not long afterwards.
They all spoke together?
Not together at the same meeting, but if you were looking at a season lineup, here's the Bethel Literary for 1918, 1919. Yeah.
Okay. Now, so, tell me this. Talk about Chief and Garveyism.
Yeah, well, this, you know, it's just so interesting. And I can't really explain it. Maybe someone with greater expertise on Garveyism can help us out. But
we should get Dr. Tolbert here.
Yeah, yeah. Well, one of Dr. Tolbert's students, and I do acknowledge him in the acknowledgments in the book. Dr. Tolbert told him about what I was working on. And this guy just showed up in the hallway of CUC, as it was then. I didn't know who he was. And I have to admit, enough of racial profiling. I mean, he was scruffy looking and wild, not extremely, but you know, it was like, who is this guy? But it turns out he's got information on Chief.
He was white or black?
Oh, he's black. Yeah, yeah. Okay. And he was a student of Dr. Tolbert's as well. But writing on Garveyism in Washington, D.C. And so that's how I found out. I was absolutely clueless about that. Yeah. But Chief was a card-carrying member, contributor to the Universal Negro Improvement Association. 1921, I think, is when document that Mario Cabal, I'm not quite getting his name exactly right, the man that helped me, but there was a Washington chapter where Chief spoke sometimes, was a leader in the 20s.
It's very consistent with Chief's life.
Yeah.
Very consistent with Chief's life. He was joining every organization, every group that he thought would uplift and help Black people.
Yeah.
Very consistent with Chief's life. I mean, I'm not surprised at all that he was a Garveyite. It makes total sense.
Yeah. All right. I think that has made more sense to me as we go on. I think that I tripped up over Chief's that you find stuff in Chief earlier where he's absolutely against any kind of, he's a total integrationist, it seems. And then here you have another ideology, it seems. But in fact, even I know I've learned enough about the UNIA to realize that it had a lot of diverse types of perspectives. And again, I agree with you 100% that the main thing that makes sense of it is, all right, here's another thing that might work. Let's try it.
Yep.
And also the emphasis on the dignity of the race. Certainly, that's totally consistent.
Yeah.
With
and self-determination.
There you go. Absolutely. Uh-huh.
And pride, race, dignity.
Right. Right.
All of these things Chief could get right on board with. Now, tell me this: Why did Chief become a Seventh-day Baptist? Why did the People's Church move to Seventh-day Baptist? What was What did that indicate? Was it no Ellen White? What was the thing with that?
The only information or document I have on this is a newspaper article, and she says that we find in the Seventh Day Baptists a kind of a greater freedom. It's more like there's more of a gospel spirit, but the article does not go into much detail beyond that.
I wonder what he meant by greater freedom when People's Church was Congregationalist.
Well, I think it's important also to say, though, that although Schieff was, he tended to get into controversies that caused him to split off from organizations, but he was also a perpetual joiner, kind of like we were just saying. It was important to him to be part of some kind of a wider fellowship. According to a Church of God history, for a time, he was associated with one of the Seventh-day Church of God groups. Apparently,
Is that Kojic? I mean, is that Church of God in Christ?
No.
Church of God.
Seventh-day, the Church of God of Seventh-day, many different branches. Many different branches. Herbert W. Armstrong would become most famous, but these are people who actually are in, they're in the descent, breakaway from Seventh-day Adventism, like the Marian Party and all of this. There's a whole tradition, but they're constantly splitting, so there's more than one of them. It's a little hard to keep track of. But apparently there was a healer, I mean, a charismatic preacher who, you know, he did healings and so forth, and apparently he had a revival at the People's Church, and according to their history, anyway, for a while, the People's Church in Washington was part of it. Now, I can read you just briefly what the article, part of the article that I alluded to. Schieff says, we have decided to seek a connection with the Seventh-day Baptists. Their church polity is the same as the regular Baptist church. Each church is its own sovereign. Its doctrines are simple. The Bible, and the Bible only, is the rule of faith and practice. They have gone farther than this and interpreted the New Testament as teaching the freedom of the individual to approach God through Christ directly, to interpret the scriptures for himself, to formulate his own beliefs, and to worship God according to the dictates of his own conscience. Seventh-day Baptists have no creedal statements to which their members must adhere, and their covenants are most simple. It's almost A.T. Jones-like. The Bible with its Christ, faith and repentance, forgiveness of sins, immersion, the Sabbath of Christ, godly living, the fatherhood of God, the brotherhood of all men is the only creed they recognize.
You interestingly say in the book that you say Schieff took the position that because of developments in church and society during the past decade, this is around 1908, race had become a decisive test of Christian integrity.
Yes.
Surpassing the Sabbath in significance.
Yes. Yes.
And so it's interesting that it seems like he always held on to the Sabbath.
Yes.
Oh, yeah. But he also held on to racial equality and integration and well, desegregation, if you will, and probably even beyond that, integration.
Yeah. Yeah. I think that in a way that sounds shocking, and from an Adventist perspective, and some of his opponents are tried to, you know, highlight it. But I look at it this way. How much courage did it take to be a Seventh-day Sabbath keeper? Well, in the 19th century, especially in the South, you could be imprisoned.
Yeah.
How much courage does it take to be a true Christian on race relations in the nadir? And so I think that's, I think that was similar to James Howard. That's the real test of true Christianity. So it's not that the Sabbath is unimportant, or that it's even not even that it, if challenged, it would be decisive. You know, it's not just something that's indifferent, but because of changes in American society, now race is an even greater test. Yeah.
Tell me how Louis Sheaf died.
Well, he died of an illness that was gradual, but it didn't cause him to stop working, really almost to the very end. And I guess you could say that he died of old age. Now you might want to pause.
Yeah, he was and we do, apparently we don't quite know how he died. I mean, he was ill.
Right.
He was said to be ill for a while.
Yeah, in failing health. But specifically what the health issues were, unclear.
And he was 78 when he died on June 24th, yes. 1938. Yeah. Doc, yeah. Can you give us his legacy?
Yeah. Well, I think his legacy for Seventh-day Adventists is both in the work that he inaugurated, especially in Washington, D.C. The early 1940s, there was a report in the Washington African American, a profile about the Ephesus SDA Church. And it started off by saying the church was founded by Elder Sheaf and Elder Harter. Now, Harter was the president of the DC Conference. And I kind of laughed at that initially. Those guys were poles apart. They didn't work together to found the church. But as I thought about it a little bit more, I realized that that was something that, while not literally true, actually told the truth about Ephesus Church of D.C., now DuPont Park, but really in a large measure to about African-American Adventism, that they draw a lot from Sheaf. And the memory of Sheaf lived on and was honored in DuPont Park. Most of the people, Shelton Kilby II, I think it would be one who died about 10 years ago. He might have been the last one who actually remembered Sheaf. But they honor him. They look to him as, you know, a founder. But at the same time, they chose to commit themselves to the idea that the Seventh-day Adventist organized church is God's last day church, and we're going to, you know, stay with it. The way in which he prompted the denomination to, by his very dissent and by the disturbance and division that you could say that he caused, but he prompted change on the part of the denomination. We mentioned 1909, but in 1918, General Conference, which was delayed a year, it's important to mention that it was originally supposed to take place in 1917. And once again, because of Sheaf and Mann's, to be sure, there is a realization on the part of the leadership. And all of a sudden, Ellen White's statement that a white man must lead, I guess that's not eternal anymore. I guess, you know, in other words, and this came as at the request of the black ministers. We need someone who is one of us, who knows us and our world, our community, our situation. And so W.H. Green was put in charge of the North American Negro Department.
A one-time chief acolyte.
Yes. Yep. He came into the message through Chief. So that's another part of his legacy. I mean, you could point to people like that and the ripple effect of their work. But I think there's something else too. For me, that a man of this kind of mentality and commitment to racial equality, justice, advance of his race, would find in Seventh-day Adventism the answer that he was very excited about. Now, all of the problems that came later, it's very, you know, it's frustrating and depressing, but it's actually an inspiration to me to realize that it was the same Louis Chief who gave that fiery speech in Springfield in 1895. It's the same man preaching at Battle Creek Tabernacle 10 months later. And his commitment to those things never changed. And so to me, it gives me an enhanced sense of the value and the possibilities of Seventh-day Adventism if, to use Chief's word, we will actually let it get a hold of us.
Very good. Thank you, Dr. Morgan. It has been an epic interview.
Well, thank you, Dr. Baker. I mean, it's just, I'm so honored that there would be this level of interest in Louis C. Chief.
Yes, and the Black SDA History family thanks you.